Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hey everybody, it's Wednesday. It's time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor. As always, I am Ken Reed. I am your host. Every week, as we go through old television using back issues of TV Guide magazine as the fulcrum of our discussions of the past, today I have two guests, two guys that I look up to quite a bit, Nick Prueher and Joe Pickett of the Found Footage Festival. If you have not seen the Found Footage Festival, you need to change that. You can buy their DVDs of all their shows. I think they're on their 9th or 10th show now. Some of which feature footage I found. I think Volume 7 has my stuff, which is very, very exciting. These guys are incredibly funny. I am a sucker for found footage stuff. They also were Chop and Steal, which was a viral video. They went around as these fake motivational speakers on sort of Midwestern morning shows as Chop and Steal, which if you haven't seen, definitely look that up, because they are currently being sued over it, which I'm sure they will win, but it is very funny, very harmless, and incredibly funny. They were in Boston recently doing a live found footage festival show, and they said, hey, let's do TV Guidance Counselor, because hey, what else are you going to do when you're in town in Boston? So I said, absolutely, and they came over my house and we recorded, and it was a great time. And you are about to hear that. You're about to hear that I'm not lying. It was indeed a great time. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy today's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guests from the Found Footage Festival, Joe Pickett and Nick Prueher.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Nick Prueher and Joe Pickett, how are you guys?
Hi, how's it going?
Hi, Ken.
Good. Thank you so much for coming. I appreciate you coming, not under false identities.
No. As us.
We're ourselves today.
This is us.
Yes. And we're sitting in my weird living room. My wife had a Twin Peaks party last night, so there's like a very realistic life-size dead Laura Palmer in the room.
It's horrifying.
It is really horrifying.
Yeah. I'm looking at it right now.
Yeah.
It's in my line of sight.
I thought it was an alligator at first because it looked like a little tail sticking out of there. And But I see now that it's Laura Palmer.
I was away last weekend in New York and I came home Saturday night late and she had built that while I was gone and like left it in the kitchen. And it was like 2 a.m. and I was like, Jesus Christ, what that? Oh, okay.
Did she use a mannequin in there? Is that what it is?
It's a mannequin head, but then she filled a leather jacket and leggings with tuna cans.
Tuna? to give it some weight.
To give it the weight.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I mean, it really could be any canned meat.
It doesn't have to be.
Okay,
it
doesn't
have
to
be ham.
I'll write that down.
Yeah.
It's good to know.
So that's the one disturbing thing that we dismantled more or less everything else, but that is still here.
Is that going to stay? I mean, is this a permanent fixture of the household now?
Fixture.
No?
I think it's a traveling exhibition.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And you want that tuna too. So,
yeah, I mean, we're going to want to eat that at some point. Yeah. And that'll stink after a while, I imagine, 40, 50 years.
Yeah.
It has to be packed in oil tuna. That's the only thing. You can't use the water kind.
Oh, yeah.
No, I don't think that's going to be a permanent fixture. No. Although, I mean, looking at our house, no one would notice.
Well, I think it looks good over
it
there.
It does look good over there. It's kind of a dead space, no pun intended.
Oh, so. Yeah.
Yes. I was out front one day and with the dogs, and this woman pulled up and goes, hey, I used to live in that house. And I was like, oh, cool. She's like, yeah, I lived there. And like, I didn't know what she wanted. It's like, I think she wanted me to invite her in. And I was like, oh, my wife would want me to ask you, like, where did you guys put your Christmas tree? She goes, what? What? I was like, where'd you put your Christmas tree? She goes, oh, in the living room. And I was like, oh, we put the Christmas tree there. And she goes, no, we never went in there. We had it blocked off. It was too cold.
Oh, so that whole front door area was just blocked off?
My dad, I was talking to my dad about our childhood home the other day, and he told me that he was there last summer. And he knocked on the door, and he wanted to go in and see the place. I was like, are you nuts? You're just knocking on a stranger's house and say, can I walk through your house right now? They weren't home, but he was prepared to do that.
That said, I would like to go in my childhood home.
Oh, I would too.
I just would not want to disturb the current residents of the home. Because
what do they get out of it?
What do they get out of it? Yeah.
So I grabbed an issue from January 20th to February 3rd, 1984, and I grabbed this issue because talking to Nick, he had a good story about Cybil Sheppard, but it was not this issue.
It wasn't. It was the Moonlighting issue, so it must have been like 88 or a couple years later, but I remember it had, you know, David and Maddie from Moonlighting, which I loved as a kid, and I think I had such a crush on Cybil Sheppard, but I wouldn't admit to my parents that I was having... Basically, I wanted to bury my budding sexuality as far as possible.
You didn't want to share that with your parents?
No.
Oh.
But my cousin, like, had a poster of, like, you know, a bikini babe in his... I know what,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, and I was like...
Yeah, yeah,
like,
yeah. Kathy Ireland.
Yeah. I was like, how can you do that? You're admitting to your parents that you're, like, you know, sexually attracted to that person. I would never do that. Yeah. And so, but so what I did as a ruse, I mean, I genuinely did like Moonlighting, but I pretended to be a big Bruce Willis fan because I thought that would be my... big cover. So yeah, so I cut out all the pictures of Bruce and Cybil from that issue of TV Guide and put them up around. I had like a mural in my bedroom, and and it was not only that, but anything that had Moonlighting in it, I would cut out, you know, Bruce and Cybil. And
but I feel like you also liked Bruce Willis, didn't you? I mean, you.
But not
had,
like,
I mean, you listened to his music.
Yeah,
I
mean, I thought he was a charming cat, but I mean, half of it is like a ruse because I wanted those pictures of Cybil Sheppard up
bedroom.
Yeah,
like you wouldn't like him enough to put up pictures of Bruce Willis in your house.
No, but like this kind of gave me a cover for that. So yeah, I had a cut up issue, and anytime Moonlighting would be, and even the black and white pictures of it, teasing the episode, I would cut them out and put them on this poster board I had in my room. And but really, I don't think my parents ever, they still don't know that I'm a sexual being, and I think that was a perfect crime.
Well, here's why, too, is that you do have some, like, naked paintings of ladies, like ironic, like 1970s paintings of naked ladies, but then whenever they come to visit you, you always take them down, right?
Yeah, well, my ex had a lot of those paintings, so yeah, I would stash them away. Yeah, yeah. There's a big poster of a naked lady that was not up when my parents were there.
And so. I remember in college, too, because we roomed together, I think you had an Elle Macpherson poster looking up from your bed, is that right?
Bottom bunk, yeah.
Yeah, bottom bunk, so it's like you're sleeping with her every night.
Yep.
And when your parents came up to visit, you took that down.
Oh, yeah,
and,
for sure. Yeah. They will never know. They don't listen to podcasts. So,
well,
no offense.
I have some news for you. They're here.
No!
Bring them up.
They're in the room with Laura Palmer. Yeah.
See,
bring
I would always
out.
Do that for my dad, but it was more because I didn't... My dad has what I dubbed divorced dad horny.
Oh.
Like that, like...
Oh, I know those dads.
Oh, yeah. Huh? Yeah. Huh?
And oh, so those dads always had the best pornography too. You'd go, I remember Heath Jepson's dad was a divorced dad, and he had the Hustlers.
Oh yeah,
he had all the ones that showed it going in, like all.
And
that
he was
stuff.
Probably like, "You boys want to see some magazines?"
Yeah. Oh no, he kept them right there on the coffee table.
Yeah, divorced dad, horny dads are like usually there's an overlap with satellite dish dads.
Oh yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
So but your dad would try to bro out with you about
Well, he was convinced that I was gay because I was just like a weird kid that read.
Did he say that to you?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he once sat me down and he goes, you know, if you're gay, your mother and I will probably still love you.
Probably.
Well, ringing endorsement.
Yeah. We'll see.
We'll see. Which I was like, oh, he's genuinely being truthful because he didn't say like definitely. I remember one time I used to get the Sears Wish book, as we all did.
Yeah.
And you'd write down all the things you wanted for Christmas that there's no way you're getting.
Yeah.
And one day I strayed from the toy section and there were silk sheets and they looked nice. I was like 10. And I put them on my list, and my dad lost his mind. He's like, who told you to put these on there?
I mean,
like some gay
guy. I'm sorry, but I'm kind of with your dad on this one.
Yeah,
a 10-year-old wanting silk sheets?
They look nice. I mean, they had a nice photo of the bed. It looked comfy.
You went nuts with that thing. You didn't just go to the toys. You went over to the sheet section?
I think I knew I wasn't getting anything in there, so I was like, I'm going to get novelty phones.
I mean, occasionally, if you were looking for, like, the the Back to the Future sheets sets, you know, they had the kids' sheet
those
sets.
Tents,
the tents. You'd occasionally see some linens that would bore you, but silk sheets,
this looked exciting. So he was convinced there was like some sort of weird like some gay guy came to the schoolyard and was like, hey, on your Christmas list this year, and that would somehow turn me or something.
Right. Do you have silk sheets now, Ken?
I don't, and I don't think I would want them.
Yeah,
because that seems.
Have you ever slept in them?
No, I've never slept in a waterbed either. I feel like those.
Oh,
two
Nick
go
grew
together.
Up in a waterbed.
Well, I wanted a waterbed.
Like the boy
so
in the plastic
bad.
Bubble.
Born in a waterbed. Yeah, he's a waterbed boy.
Yeah. I thought I really wanted a waterbed because it just seemed like a cool, like silver spoons kind of thing to have.
Yeah.
And so. one day my parents relented, and it just was not a comfortable. In the summers, it was just always hot.
All through high school, ooh, too, right?
Yeah, I mean, yeah.
It'd be like a giant hot water bottle.
That's what it felt like.
It was
like.
A really... I remember because we've known each other since we were in sixth grade.
Yeah.
And so I would stay overnight, and I'd stay in the same... We'd stay in the same bed. And I remember just... You'd feel every... Yeah. It was really wavy. Oh, it was so wavy.
Yeah, yeah.
It would make noises.
You couldn't sit on the bed, obviously, either. Yeah. So it was not a practical bed at
all.
And
I mean, I, you know, one of the ways that I first started watching you guys stuff was because I have tape traded for years and years and years. And someone's like, you got to check these guys out. They're just... And, but there was so many television ads for waterbed companies and stores, like for decades. It was like, I think I have tapes where the only thing they advertise is like eight different local waterbed stores.
They loved waterbeds.
Luxury back then. Yeah.
But then all of a sudden they just stopped.
Yeah.
I bet
yeah.
you couldn't find one now.
No,
new one? Like, I bet they don't make new waterbeds.
I for a time I was like, are they outlawed? Because like you never see them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's
my
true.
Dad had, in the 80s, my dad has one rich friend, one guy from college from his group that got rich, and he had a yacht on the lake in Chicago.
Ooh.
And we
Ooh.
Took it out one day, and I remember like we ate a nice lunch there. He had like a chef on board, but I got seasick. I wasn't used to being on a boat. So
Ironically.
I know. I said, could I go lie down? And he goes, yeah, go downstairs to the bedroom. And I went downstairs to this master bedroom on the yacht, and it was a waterbed. So that didn't help at all because it was like a waterbed on
it's not
a
like
boat.
Two wrongs make a right.
Exactly. Like, they didn't cancel each other out at all.
You're probably like, this is fresh water. You should really have salt water. If you're
yeah,
gonna
exactly.
be in a boat.
No, I'm a purist.
Yeah, that is not a fun thing.
Yeah.
And you know what else was big on game shows? Brass beds.
Oh yeah.
It's like a ooh, but I'm like that.
Yeah.
Is not a fun.
No.
Prize.
Like, yeah. Oh, especially on like Price is Right when that would come up.
Yeah.
You could see the people look on their face. They were not excited either.
Oh, a bedroom set. Great.
Yeah.
But like a brass bed, especially like. And I've also known like I go to a lot of flea markets, and old people really overvalue brass. They seem to think it's like a real.
Yeah.
Like that's solid brass, and I'm like, okay.
Oh yeah.
It's kind of like gold.
Yeah. But that's like I'm saying if you're buying a paint and they're like. That's made out of real oil paints. I'm like, well, I don't.
Well, right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's
fine.
Just metal.
But yeah.
Yeah.
It's there, and they always point out solid brass. Like I'm gonna be like, I took this home and it was fake brass.
Yeah.
It's brass plated.
Who cares?
Yeah, nobody cares except old people.
Yeah.
That seems to.
Is it because it's shiny?
I don't know. I don't know if there was ever like. I actually looked this up because I got all the time on my hands, and I was like, was brass like valuable at some point, like in the war?
Oh right.
Didn't get anything? And no. They just,
well, there's Lay Lady Lay across my big brass bed.
That's right. But I don't think they were all, that was why.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like Bob Dylan has to bless all brass.
No, but brass beds were a thing, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah. So we're here at in 1984. This is the non-Bruce Willis issue of TV Guide with Cybil Sheppard on the cover.
Yep. The quote is, you'd better say I'm sexy.
That's right.
Yeah.
And you've read Curtis Armstrong's book.
I have.
He has that crazy story where she's like, don't say anything nice to me.
Yes.
And
yeah.
He thinks she's kidding. And he says, you were really great in the show last night. And she just bursts into tears and locked herself in her trailer.
Yeah.
Because she's a nut person. She's a crazy
person. It sounded like it. Yeah.
Yeah. But she was so funny on that show and amazing on that show.
Did you watch Moonlighting at all?
We didn't. No. It wasn't That wasn't.
Have you watched it since at all?
I haven't. No.
No, never.
I mean, I think I watched a little bit. I remember a little bit, but I remember being bored by it.
The thing I really liked is, one, they just revealed who did the murder right away.
Yeah. It
was
like,
never a mystery.
Who did the murder?
And then they had overlapping dialogue, which I had never seen on TV before, where they're just talking at the same time. And then,
like, you really liked that when you were eight?
I did.
It's real,
I was
like His Girl Friday, Screwball, Saturday, Sunday afternoon, black and white movie kind of thing.
Yeah, it was slapstick. And I also liked that they broke the fourth wall and talked to the.
Did they?
Audience.
Oh yeah, all the time.
Yeah,
They would always reference like the show was always late because they were nightmares, and like a 24 episode season would be like 15 episodes because sometimes they just wouldn't make an episode, and like they'd have them come out and be like, we didn't make a new one this week. And like talk to the camera, they reference it all the time.
It was like a really self-referential thing, which was sort of a groundbreaking. You know that the Gary Shan, it's Gary Shandling show. Like I just always loved that sledgehammer. I loved all that break the fourth wall kind of stuff.
What's she promoting in this TV guide? Is it Moonlighting or
so
is it?
Let's see what they say here. Yeah, it's not Moonlighting. They really don't even.
Oh, she was on an episode of like they're talk in the back. They show her on like. Remington Steele, or no, the Heartbreak Kid. I don't know.
Yeah, because she was a failed movie actress
right.
in the eyes of television by this point. Cause it, so, which was like, if you were a movie actor and then you went to TV, it was like, oof.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's like doing Topless.
I just watched Taxi Driver the other day on an airplane.
Oh, she's so
great in that. Yeah.
I remember seeing an interview with Albert Brooks talking about Taxi Driver. And when I first saw the interview, I was like, wow, what a dick. Because he was like, well, the character I'm playing, I had to be like normal person funny, you know, like funny guy in your office. And I'm really, really funny. So I had to be less funny than I am. And I was like, what a jerk. But then I'm like, no, he's right, though.
Yeah.
Like, he's
yeah. Not, he like, had to be fake. Like,
oh, he makes the dumbest
style.
Jokes. Yeah. Like, yeah. You remember the one with the what she brings in, like the matches to have yes. him tear off the yes. matches, and he can only do it with his two fingers or something.
Yes.
It's like such a weird scene. Yeah.
I got my favorite rejection for a guest on the show from Albert Brooks's manager, Herb. Who says this won't happen, Herb? That was the whole email. This won't happen, Herb.
Well, no like, beating around the bush enough, there. Yeah. You know where you stand.
Thanks, Herb.
We got that from Weird Al Yankovic's manager. Yeah. He was just like, not gonna.
Really?
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. It was just like, nope. It was just something like glib.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I appreciate that they got back to
sure.
you.
Yeah, exactly. It was nice of them to do that.
And then Joan Collins sent me a really angry reply once that said, this sounds like publicity for publicity's sake, and Dame Collins does not do such things.
Oh, boy.
And
yeah.
Dame my Collins. Wife's like, first of all, if you're a dame, she'd be Dame Joan, not Dame Collins. So yeah. either she doesn't know how her damehood works, or like her assistant wrote that.
Yeah.
Like, who's the most surprising one that said yes? Like that you weren't expecting to say yes?
Rose McGowan.
Oh, really?
Who else? Like Cassandra Peterson was a good one that I was surprised. Oh, The Damned.
Oh, yeah?
Okay. Were, wow.
I was like... And I got weirdly got like the longest interview Dave Vanian from The Damned has ever done, and we just talked about like Hammer horror movies and his dad.
Yeah, maybe that's like really a little
weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. There's been some odd ones. Lydia Lunch was I was obviously that was a weird one.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's always strange. Yeah. Who wants to talk about old television?
We did a short film called Glue Man, and we just on a whim called it was about like the documentary world.
Yep.
And we just on a whim called up Ken Burns. Oh, and yeah. asked him to be in, and he said yes.
Yeah, he seems so up we for got like anything.
Yeah. yeah, and he was hilarious. Yeah.
He was hilarious. He read every line we gave him, and then Morgan really? Spurlock came on after that. So we got
yeah. There's so many people who it's like just no one asks them.
Yeah,
or like if it's just if it sounds fun, they're just like yeah, sure,
mm-hmm. right, yeah,
which is very very strange.
Yeah.
So I had you guys do this sort of newlywed game style. In that, I will ask you every night with the word whoopee in the title. You both picked sort of independently, mm-hmm. and I'm curious to see if you made the same choices.
I bet we did.
There's going to be some crossover, yeah.
Especially since you guys have been friends.
I threw in a couple wild cards in here, though.
Just see? Yeah. Let's dive right in. On Saturday night at 8 o'clock, what would you guys go with?
Different Strokes.
Okay.
Silver Spoons and Beastmaster.
Okay, so you went with the lineup until 9, and then you went whole hog HBO.
Yeah, but Beastmaster doesn't... It was like the middle of Beastmaster, which I feel like that's where I've always watched it.
Well, that's
it.
When Tanya Roberts' nude scene is. It's yeah. like, an hour in.
Yeah.
It was a Dennis Leary joke about HBO. Have you ever heard that one?
No.
HBO stands for Hey Beastmaster's On. It was on all the time. It was like the only
It was.
Thing.
Yeah. That's how I saw it.
There's certain movies that's always on HBO. All the Police Academies.
Yeah,
those
just
are
just one of the guys.
Just one of the guys, yeah.
Hot Dog the Motion Picture.
Secret Admirer.
Yep.
But
Beastmaster was like nonstop.
Yeah.
Oh, always.
And then TBS became the Beastmaster station.
Yeah. Yeah.
Then they were just
well, that's what I think. It's still funny on HBO where they do those really, you know, they'll do like before an episode of Curb Your Enthusiasm or something, they'll play some cool song and they'll just have all the coolest moments from like Game of Thrones and The Deuce and all these things. And you're like, wow, this network's incredible. And then like you turn on as soon as those shows are done, it is Beastmaster still and you know, movies no one wants to see.
The Barbarian Brothers and Think Big.
Oh yeah.
That's still most of what HBO is. And then there's 2 hours where they play good shows.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. I mean it was that way when we were growing up, except the 2 hours of good shows was Tales from the Crypt and Dream On.
Dream On.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Maybe First and Ten.
Yeah. but like a show like Beastmaster, I don't think I've ever seen it from the beginning to the end. I've probably seen the movie.
Yeah.
Like, because I jump in 2/3 of the way in, then I leave, you know.
Which you can
25 minutes in, and I still feel like I know what's going on.
Rip Torn's the villain in that, isn't he?
Oh, is he?
Yeah, I think he is. Yeah, he's like wearing robes and is like a black magic like evil magician.
See, I always get confused with Beastmaster and Clash of the Titans.
Yeah.
I picture both of them, those movies both combine in my head.
They're very similar in a lot.
Yeah, and they were also on TBS all the time.
Yeah, Beastmaster 2, Through the Portal of Time, was made for TBS because the show was so popular. The movie was so popular on TBS.
Oh, so they funded the sequel. Wow.
Starring Kari Wern.
I have seen that one, actually. Yeah.
Did Beastmaster, did it do well in the theaters?
No.
Do you remember?
No. No Don Coscarelli movie did well in the theaters. But Phantasm was a huge bomb. Beastmaster. But they became such, people loved them in home video, which is why he made it's sequels crazy. To pretty much every movie he's ever done.
Yeah.
It's all been because after the fact, people kind of discovered them for whatever weird reason, except for Kenny and Company, which nobody likes.
I haven't seen that.
It was the first movie that he made.
Oh.
And it's like a sweet, children's comedy.
Oh, okay.
But there's a Halloween scene in it, and that's where he got the idea to do Phantasm.
Oh.
It's really weird. Different Strokes this night. There's a weird thing that TV Guide does, and I don't know why they do this, and this is the only show they do it for, but they never call Mr. Drummond anything except Drummond.
They don't call him Mr. Drummond?
Nope. No first name, no Mr. It's the only character I've seen this in.
Hmm.
So someone at TV Guide had a weird vendetta that they were like, Drummond. So ignoring Drummond's repeated warnings... Arnold and Kimberly accept a ride from a stranger who takes into his apartment, promising to show them aerospace films.
Oh, wow. That's a great description.
Here's a trivia question. What was Mr. Drummond's first name?
I don't even know.
Do you know it?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't know either. Yeah. I wonder if they ever revealed that.
I don't know. That's a great question.
Maybe it was One Drummond. And that's what the lyrics in the theme song were. His name is One Drummond. Don't move to the beat of just One Drummond.
Oh, yeah.
That's actually his full name.
Oh,
that's it. Yeah.
I think you uncovered something there.
I think I may have. But this is one of the lesser beloved, very special Different Strokes.
Yeah, because we recently rewatched the...
Mr. Bicycle
Man? The Bicycle Shop Guy episode.
Yeah, we were on a long drive and we just looked on YouTube and was like, oh, it's here. So we watched it.
Yeah.
Gordon Jump.
The weird part is the laugh track on it.
Oh, yeah.
They're still trying to be a sitcom during this.
And I always wonder, and there's some jokes in there about the molestation, specifically one, the game they make up that he makes Dudley play. Do you remember what it was called?
No, I don't.
Neptune, King of the Sea. Which is clearly written to be a joke,
you
made me play Neptune, King of the Sea.
Yeah.
But so some old, 70-year-old guy's like, okay.
Yeah.
Neptune, King of the Sea. Take your shirt off. Yeah, it's...
There's so much disturbing about that. So
this is a two-parter where this guy literally kidnaps them and chains them to a radiator.
Oh, yeah.
But do they get to watch the aerospace films?
They never get to see the aerospace films, but they do watch a movie called Neptune, King of the Sea.
The poor Drummond kids, they were really under siege from predators at every turn.
But it was such a... I always joke that they're pitching episodes for the year, and you're like, all right, Arnold's goldfish dies. They replace it with one that looks like he doesn't find out. Perfect. They throw a potty when Drummond's out. He doesn't know. Perfect. Dudley gets molested, and they're like... Yeah, well, okay. And then the next whatever. Yeah.
But we watched the other molestation one,
Mr.
too.
Mr. Belvedere?
Yeah, Mr. Belvedere. Yeah. We watched that one right after it.
There's two on Mr. Belvedere.
Oh, really?
The camp counselor is the one I remember.
Did they get paid kickbacks or something for that? Or was that marijuana? No. Or is that just like a...
So there was talk on the Growing Pains cocaine episode, which actually does have one of my favorite jokes on Growing Pains. They go to a party. I love Growing Pains, by the way. They go to a party and they're all doing coke in the bathroom. And Mike doesn't want to do it, so he leaves. But Boner and Eddie stay. And then Mike gets home, and Mr. Seaver goes, Mike, Boner and Eddie just called. They said they're not going to the bathroom, and they don't want to. And then he's like, oh, great. And he goes, I don't want to know what that's about. And I'm like, that's actually really funny.
Yeah, that's pretty good. Yeah.
But then Kirk Cameron has a talk to the screen about drugs at the end of it.
Oh, yeah.
And that one I'm always like, this feels court-ordered.
Yeah.
This does not feel...
I heard that they always got money for having the anti-marijuana or from the government or something.
Yeah, for the Just Say No stuff.
Yeah.
Different Strokes probably did when they had Nancy Reagan guest star. They did a Just Say No one, and she came in and was all like...
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think children's programming had a mandate that a certain amount of television had to be... Or maybe it was just the networks had a certain amount had to be educational.
Yep.
So if they could work that into some one or two primetime episodes that there was an educational value, check that off the list. Same with G.I. Joe.
Right. and had Super Friends.
And had the little lessons at the, you know, that was all to meet that quota.
It was a way to have a half-hour tour commercial that counted as education.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Shoehorned in.
Yep. Yeah, but I don't know if it translated to, like, the sitcoms.
That's why I thought special episodes existed, was because they were, you know, trying to be educational.
I had Bryce Beckham on from, he was Wesley on Mr. Belvedere, and I asked him, because that the AIDS episode specifically of that has haunted me forever.
What happened in that one?
His friend, that's episode called Wesley's Friend, gets AIDS from a blood transfusion, and they kick him out of school, and like everyone's like, yeah, screw you, kid. But there's a line in it where like Wesley doesn't want anything to do with him, and then like you hear that AIDS is, and like Bob Euchre's like, ah, oh, Christ, Belvedere, like, he's gonna give it to my kid. And Mr. Belvedere's like, George, you can't get AIDS from being friends. Like, it's a whole thing.
I love when Bob Euchre was forced to be like a dramatic, you know, I remember the camp counselor when he's like, hey, that's a bad touch, champ. You know, it's like,
oh, yeah, yeah. Well, there's one where he beats a guy up who date rapes Heather.
Oh, my God.
Euchre does? Do they show the beating up?
No.
Do they show the fight?
Like, I'm going to kill him.
Like, he goes, Euchre. Out,
yeah.
I think, wasn't Euchre confused as to why he got on that show? I mean,
yeah,
and I think it was because he was in Miller Lite commercials and people loved him in that.
They built the show around him. And the guys who, the studio had the rights to the Mr. Belvedere movies, which were like British movies from the 40s. And they're like, okay, and we got Euchre with a development deal. Yeah. So they just smashed them together and hired all these guys who worked on Barney Miller.
Oh.
Who worked on that show. Huh. Which is why some of it had kind of that edge to it. But it was just a weird show. And the Amish episode's a favorite as well, where Kevin starts dating an Amish girl on a Rumspringa. She's done with the Rumspringa, so he decides to become Amish.
You gotta be kidding me.
No, this is a real plot line, yeah.
What?
Yeah.
I could have write this stuff down.
Oh, yeah. Belvedere had some of the crazy... There's one where Heather and her friend Angela break this old lady out of an old folks home, and the lady dies. they just leave her there. She dies in like Atlantic City, like on the boardwalk.
Is it like a sad moment, or is it like a funny moment?
No, it's like a sad moment, but there's still jokes in there. Like in the AIDS episode, so Wesley ends up playing Lincoln in the school play because the kid with AIDS was supposed to play Lincoln, but they kick him out of school because, you know, we don't want him around here.
Right.
And there's a black kid at the lunch table, and Wesley goes, hey, if you give me a cupcake, I'll free you. Because he's playing like, I'm like, Jesus Christ!
No way!
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. That show has some real...
that stuff snuck through.
Yeah.
The Barney Miller writers. So
I mean, they knew what they were doing. Like that's at first. Until I learned that, I was like, maybe they didn't. I'm like, oh, they knew exactly what they were doing.
Yeah.
They were like, we wrote it. We didn't think they'd let us do it, but it's in there. There's one where Kevin date rapes somebody.
Oh
what?
My God.
Yeah.
Wow.
Is Kevin the kid?
Older brother.
The older brother? Yeah. He date raped somebody?
Yeah.
Does he go to jail or something?
No, no, but like they have to have a whole talk with him about how that's not right.
Do they turn the camera at the end?
No.
To talk to the audience?
Surprisingly, no, but really? He's like kind of drunk. He's like, hey, she wanted it, man. Like it's this whole, it's ridiculous.
I don't remember how my kid brain processed the special episodes because I don't even remember them. I just remember that this was like funny sitcoms. So.
I always felt like I was going to get in trouble.
Yeah, like you weren't supposed to watch them?
Yeah, like I'm told my parents I'm watching a sitcom and it like...
It got adult.
Yeah,
kind of.
It got adult and didn't warn me and they're somehow going to tell on me because of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, it never happened.
Well, I picked Different Strokes and Silver Spoons too. I love Silver Spoons.
I do too,
We were a sitcom family, so I would have watched that.
Yeah, you were saying there was nothing but sitcoms.
My dad thought action shows were stupid, so I never watched A-Team. I never watched...
No drama either, right?
He would stay up and watch China Beach or L.A. Law, but then I would go to my room at
that
point.
What about like Dallas and stuff? Would you watch those? Or
no, not the
Dynasty
soaps.
Falcon Crest?
None of the primetime soaps.
Have you ever gone back and watched any of those now as an adult to like try and...
We watched 30-something in college for a while. That was and it was good, actually. Yeah. I was surprised because I made fun of it. Like, Dad, this is the most boring show in the world.
Yeah.
Who cares about the problems of a bunch of 30-somethings?
Yeah, but we didn't watch it reverently.
No,
I mean,
no.
We would watch it and make fun of it.
Yeah, but then we actually were like, this isn't actually that bad.
Were we watching the Lifetime reruns?
Yeah, I think so. Lifetime. Yeah.
Days and Nights of Molly Dodd. 30-something and Sisters.
Sisters we watched for a while, yeah.
Love that.
Well, like the 30-something, the cast then, they didn't seem like 30-something. I mean,
no,
I'm 41
now.
Don't they seem way older? Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Tim Busfield's, I was like, he's like got to be 60.
Poindexter.
Yeah.
I think that's why we first started watching this, because Poindexter
It was weird seeing him not be Poindexter.
I know. It's hard to believe it's the same guy.
Even though he was on that show for like 5 years and it's easily the most high profile thing he did. You're like,
all those guys, like even Anthony Edwards, I still see him as not Lewis.
Oh,
what's
yeah.
his
Gilbert.
Name?
Gilbert.
Gilbert, yeah. yeah.
They're doing yeah. a full Nerds cast reunion at Rhode Island Comic Con this year with everybody but Anthony Edwards.
But I'm going to still won't do it.
Everybody.
Busfield?
Yeah. Busfield.
They should have him appear as like a.
Don Gibb.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Ogre. Which one's Don Gibb?
Ogre.
Ogre. Oh,
they got
really?
Poindexter.
Ogre,
they
you asshole.
Tekashi.
Oh, I'm going to that. Where yeah. is it?
It's on Rhode Island Comic Con. It's in November sometime.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. We got to make a point.
Yeah. yeah. Everybody. Larry B. Scott. It's the whole crew.
They going to do panels and all that? And
I think so. Rhode Island yeah. Comic Con's weird because they, it's clearly run by someone who doesn't like anything, but just goes, yeah, everything. Yeah, we got people from Supernatural, Miami Vice, titty models, Sopranos. Yeah. Like, they don't care.
Yeah.
And there's no rhyme or reason to, like, where people are set up either.
Yeah.
So they don't put, like, all the nerds people in one room. They're just like, eh, whatever. And, yeah, it's, I got in an argument with Christy Swanson there one year about Donald Trump.
Oh,
she's
God.
A big Trump fan.
Oh, really? Boy.
She's one of those people who's like, yeah, I like Trump. What do you think? Fuck you.
Oh,
like,
just kind of daring
to be.
Yeah.
She's That's a weirdo. Great. And Sounds Scott Baio blocked me on Twitter. But anyway.
Oh, but yeah, I switched over to Love Boat because I saw they had Ted McGinley at 9 o'clock hour. So.
So this is 84. So this is the final season of Love Boat, which I didn't really need to say because you said McGinley was in it.
Oh, right. That's the death knell for any show, knell. Right?
But speaking of nerds, he's going to be at the thing too.
McGinley. Wow. What why do they do these things? Are they hurting for money or do they like to relive their glory days?
A mixture of both. Like they've been having me do a lot of Q&As and stuff at conventions since I started doing this show. And I've been going to conventions for, I don't know, 30 years. And you have people that's how they make their living now. But there's fewer of those people now. There's a bunch of people who are like, wow, for a weekend I can make a couple grand. Then there are people who are just like, that was fun. And then there are people, if they're doing like a whole cast reunion, like it's an excuse for them to get to go hang out with their friends. So they'll go. Which is what it seems like for nerds, because they're all like pretty in touch with each other still, but don't like hang out that often.
Yeah.
So it seems like they're all like, yeah, cool.
Convention, do they pay them like a flat fee to come there?
It depends on who it is. So like some people, they pay a flat fee. Usually a lot of the people, they'll just like fly them out and put them up, and then they make like whatever they make.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they like the big name people, they'll pay so that they can get people in the door. But it's such a, that bubble's got to burst like any minute.
Right.
There's too many of them, and the novelty of like meeting some of the people is just not exciting anymore.
Right.
I think for a lot of people. So Love Boat was always, I would watch Love Boat because I feel like you got good value for money there, in that it's an hour long show, but you're basically getting like five sitcoms.
Yeah. It was kind of a movie, but with like the little,
And this one is May December Newlyweds, played by Dean Paul Martin and Lee Merriweather, face strong resentment from the woman's son, played by an actor I never heard of, and a former kiddie show host, played by Barnard Hughes, tries to cheer a youngster, played by David Faustino, who's lost his father.
Wow. Well,
it's a mouthful.
Yeah, I think I made the right choice there.
I think you made the right
choice. We were on a flight to France one time, and they had the entertainment options were not that great, and so they had basically like channels that were playing stuff on a loop. And I think the first time I ever saw a Love Boat episode was on that Air France flight.
Oh wow,
yeah, that's right.
We were doing a show in Paris, so we flew over there, and it was a Rosie Grier episode.
Nice.
And we watched it twice.
we watched it on the way there, and we watched it on the way back.
Well, yeah,
it's such an anomaly. It's such like a weird time capsule because like, Doc and Gavin McLeod are always like super horny.
Yeah.
Which is weird to see like some old dudes in charge on a show being like, ooh boy. And then like they'd have a dramatic episode in the same episode as like Bumbling Diamond Thieves and then a woman's terminal cancer trip.
It wasn't just a comedy then. My mom watched it, but I didn't.
There
watch
were love
it.
Stories. A lot of them were, right?
Yeah. There's like one episode that I always remember. It was this blind couple. And they're married, and one of them had surgery, so he's not blind anymore, but he didn't know how to tell her. And so they're on this cruise, and he's pretending to be blind still. And then he tells her she doesn't want to marry him anymore because he's not blind too. And then one of my favorite ones, there's a kid who lies all the time. And he lies and says this woman tried to commit suicide on the boat, and she didn't. And then a woman really tries to commit suicide on the boat. And this kid, he's like a 12-year-old little jerk, like a real Jason Hervey, who's like, lady, please don't kill yourself. Both my parents did. And so what? She doesn't. And then he's lying about
it. He's lying about that. So the lesson is that lie at the right time.
There's no redemption. That's the end.
So convoluted. I bet it was called The Boy Who Cried Suicide. I think it actually was something
like that. And because I thought, obviously trite writer, his parents committed to the fine. But then with the jury, you're just lying. I was like,
right.
What the hell?
Yeah. The lesson.
Yeah. All right, lady.
Well, they just had to crank out so many of these. I feel like it was just such
quantity over quality.
I mean, one of my dream eras to work would just to be a TV writer in the 80s. I just feel like you could just do whatever the hell you want.
Oh, yeah.
They just didn't care.
No.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like you pitch whatever and they're like, can you write it by tomorrow? Fine. Mm-hmm.
Zero respect for the audience.
Yeah. Well, Punky Brewster had an episode written by an 8-year-old. Do you remember that?
No.
The Cherry in the Fridge episode they had a contest where kids could write episodes and mail them in. And a kid named Jeremy Reems, age 8, because they had George Gaines want to be like, tonight's episode was written by Jeremy Reems, age 8. And it was the one where Cherry gets caught in the fridge and they have to do CPR. And I've been looking for that kid. I cannot find him.
The one who wrote the episode?
Just to find out if he actually wrote it.
Yeah. What the hell happened?
I bet he didn't.
I'm sure he didn't. He pops up at the beginning and he's with
probably Jerry Stahl or somebody like that.
It's just so weird.
You tried looking him up?
I've tried looking him up. Yeah. I can't find him. And I'm like, he's got to be real. Maybe he's an actor playing this guy. I don't know what the deal was, but it fascinated me as a kid.
Yeah.
Did you try writing an episode or something?
I think I did write in ideas. I entered every contest and every single, and I wanted to do a super toy run.
That's what I was just going to say. Did you ever get to do one? Or?
No, I did dry runs, though. My parents would just dump me at the toy store, and they would go play Keno. And so I would, time myself, fill a cart, and then just leave it there.
My dad won a shopping spree at an Ace Hardware. Maybe 15 years ago, and they let him come into practice too.
Really? Yeah. So it was like a fill a cart.
It was like a full on, grab a cart, drop off the cart, grab another cart, run out.
What was the best thing you got?
An enormous grill, a huge grill.
I just want to do supermarket sweep or something.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think that's what he went for. I think he did the supermarket sweep approach to it to try and get the most expensive stuff. Yeah,
he got the roast beef.
Yeah,
and then the diapers.
Yeah,
roast beef and diapers.
Jerry's found the diapers. You can only grab 5.
How is an indie band not called an album Roast Beef and Diapers?
Yeah.
Which sounds so dirty, but it's just that's the secret.
Or that's the story of Supermarket Sweep. That's the book title.
Right,
Roast Beef and Diapers, the David Ruprecht story.
Right.
I always thought that was the funniest. The guys get game show host named Ruprecht.
Yeah. David Ruprecht. Wore a lot of sweaters. Yeah. I remember that.
When you hear the beep. And I also loved the companion show to that, which was Shop Till You Drop.
I vaguely remember it.
Hosted by Mark L. Wahlberg of Antiques Roadshow.
Oh, really?
Oh, that Mark Wahlberg, right.
It's Mark L. Wahlberg.
Was it on the same channel or was it?
Yeah, they were both on Lifetime.
Okay.
And then there was one called Treasure Mall that was hosted by Hal Sparks. That was
Is this a one season?
Yeah.
Okay.
And he is not happy to be hosting it.
Mm.
And I have one episode and Hal Sparks is kind of a dick to these kids. says here you like doing investigative journalism. You do any investigative journalism lately? To this 8-year-old kid. And the kid goes, yes, actually. And then goes on this really long answer about some story he wrote about school lunches. And Hal Sparks is so sorry that he asked.
Do you remember seeing that, or did you just watch it recently on YouTube or something?
I watched it recently, so I had it on. I have 10,000 DVDRs of old TV, and someone sent me an episode.
Oh, nice!
And I was like, "This is fantastic! This is just." I always love people having to interact with kids who shouldn't interact with kids, not for criminal reasons, but just they don't know how to.
Yeah,
right.
When his whole career is made out of being a snarky jerk,
yes, actually. He's like, oh, no, I didn't expect that.
Yeah.
So you guys had 50% match on that.
Yeah.
Pretty
yeah.
close.
Yeah.
We differed on Beastmaster and Love Boat.
Yeah.
So.
Which is fine. Both are, shining examples of love. Sunday night, 8 o'clock, what'd you guys go with?
Sundays to me were always movie, until Amazing Stories and stuff came out. But
the Simpsons was that.
Yeah, Simpsons.
It
but like
to, it turned into Sunday night turned into a hot night.
It did, but Fox early on that. It was a lot of movies and the Disney Sunday night movie.
Yep.
And so I went a movie I wouldn't have watched as a kid, but I would watch now. I went with Poltergeist nice. At 8 o'clock.
Nice.
And then I finished up at the 9 o'clock hour with Airplane 2, which I would have watched as a kid for sure on a Sunday night.
Yeah. Did they have nudity in it?
No. Oh, it was okay. PG.
It didn't even have the jiggle of part one.
Yeah, what I was wondering. Yeah.
No. Yeah. And it wasn't by the Zucker brothers either, so I remember it not being as funny, but...
It's a spaceship, right?
Like yeah.
It's a, yeah.
It's a spaceship.
But it has most of the cast.
Yeah, yep.
Yeah, it is a little disappointing, but yeah. I enjoyed that.
Robert Hayes is in it. And, yeah.
I had a tough time with Sunday night. I was looking forward to Sunday night because I always thought Sunday nights were awesome, and then it was just really tough. So, but what I threw down there, this is my wild card that I threw here. Pat Robertson was having a live telethon.
Nice. Nice.
And I put that on there because I would live telethons are the best.
Did you always used to watch those like growing up?
Oh, yeah. They'd always kind of be on the background like throughout the day. But there were so many screw-ups during them, too.
Because
it's live television. So
I miss that like hostage live television, like 3 days of just people losing their mind.
Yes, exactly. Especially Jerry Lewis, too. Oh, yeah. Like he was,
bedraggled and the tie would loosen and
I can't believe you guys passed up this made-for-TV movie.
Well, I didn't see the description.
World War III.
I saw that. I saw that in there. I didn't read what the description
President
was.
McKenna, played by Rock Hudson, and Secretary Gorney, played by Brian Teeth, conduct an exercise in brinkmanship. This is David Soule, Kathy Lee Crosby, Catherine Helmand. It's all about World War III.
Wow. So kind of a disaster movie, but
there was a lot in like 84 because we had V, which was about Nazis, and America, which was about the Soviet Union doing a soft coup of the United States.
That's true. That that time, you know, there was like a lot of Red Scare movies. And,
Red Dawn.
That was all that era.
I saw that with my dad, and that opening scene where the people parachute in and kill everybody at the high school.
Yeah,
I was like really scared about it, and I was like, oh, and my dad goes, that could happen.
I love your dad.
Thanks.
Your dad's great.
Yeah. Thank you.
Have you ever had your dad on your podcast?
I haven't yet. We were going to do a Father's Day one last year.
Oh, you should.
I think we're going to do one this year.
Talk about the gay thing. Talk about the silk sheets.
Yeah. when he was a kid, he was on the Bozo the Clown show. And he
really?
Told me about it forever. And I got it. I got the episode.
You found that episode?
Like on the grand prize game or just in the audience?
In the audience, but my uncle was Butch for a Day. And so, like, you can see them. And then at the end, and this is the Boston one because they were the different bozos, they have this robot come out. And my dad is 6 or 7, dances with this robot to a song called Chicken Curry. It's like a swing song. Just goes, Chicken Curry, Chicken Curry. And my dad's, like, cutting a rug with this robot.
Oh, man.
And it is wonderful.
Wait a second. You just blew my mind. There's a Boston Bozo?
Oh yeah, Bozo was a franchise.
Had no idea.
Each market had a different Bozo, and the Chicago Bozo and the Boston Bozo were like the last two standing, and they hated each other, and they were constantly suing each other over who could be the only Bozo.
What?
Yeah.
Yeah, we grew up with the Chicago Bozo, and I knew friends who were on
did
the grand prize game.
No, okay. Cookie. But Romper Room was also a franchise show, so it was different in every market. Mm. And the Boston Romper Room lost their franchise for corruption.
Oh wow!
Because they were using the show just to sell Romper Room stuff that they made, and it was literally like a half hour commercial every week, and they lost their Romper Room franchise.
Wow!
Did you have any local Wisconsin kid shows?
Yeah, there was one called Story Lords that was like a PBS show produced locally, and it was a really low budget.
In school.
Yeah,
they'd show it to you like educational.
Yeah, there's a nerdy kid named Norbert who would go on an exercise bike, like a stationary bike, while reading these magic words and be transported to this other world and have to solve a mystery by using clues in a story.
Okay.
And it was shot in like Wisconsin somewhere.
Really cheesy graphics.
I feel like I need to see that. Have you tracked it down?
Yeah,
I think somebody gave us some tapes.
Yeah, we have
something.
Some episodes.
Yeah, in our storage locker.
Mm-hmm.
We have some.
Ooh, that sounds pretty exciting.
Yeah.
We had a show called Ready to Go, RTG, that was on every morning. It was like a kid's, like, Good Morning America, but it was pretty much an excuse to just have New Kids on the Block on every day.
Oh.
And a friend of mine, this was in elementary school, went, and it was the debut of Marky Mark and the Funky Bunch. And we were, I don't know, 7 or 8. And he comes out in his underwear and pulls her out of the audience. She's 8 years old. And he whispers something to her. This is on YouTube. and I found it recently. And I was like, what the hell did he whisper to you? And she goes, he asked me if I had a man. And then I said no. And he said, don't ever let a man play you.
Wow.
Like, I'm
it's embarrassed. On YouTube. And it's like knowing what he's saying watching it now, it's so much
better. Oh, she's like, yeah. Okay, I won't.
She's like, sure. All right. Yeah.
Try not to.
Yeah. And I remember there was one where Jordan Knight was going on about his own designs and creations for dances.
And oh, he's wow.
It's like, this is an invention of my own design. And he's going on with, oh, it's great.
Did you hear their interview on Stern recently?
No.
They came out, I think it was last summer, actually. Yeah.
We'll listen to
that. It's pretty good.
I love the Behind the Music one because Jonathan Knight goes on and on about his, quote, wicked bad anxieties.
Oh, boy.
I was having, like, wicked bad anxieties. Yeah.
Oh,
it was
boy.
Wonderful. Monday Night, what'd you guys go with?
That's Incredible.
Mm.
Because I loved that show when I was a kid.
I still love that show.
But I have no idea what it's about. I haven't retained any of it.
It was a freak show.
It was
like just a freak show. Because Real People was the sort of rival show. And that was more of like slightly more of a magazine show. Like they would be like, here's a kid who graduated high school when she was 9 years old. You know, and they do like a segment. But That's Incredible would be like, here's a yogi in a box. And this guy catches bullets with his teeth.
Right.
It was just like a...
Yeah.
This episode is... segments include a street shooter whose targets head toward him at 100 miles per hour. I don't know what a street shooter is. A downhill race between a car and a skier in San Francisco on the street, and a blind steer in its seeing eye duck.
And I watched that today.
A process that turns garbage into gasoline.
Oh, why aren't there more shows like that on now?
I mean, I feel like you could pitch a blind steer and a seeing eye duck as like a buddy cop movie and just...
Yeah.
Be doing fine.
Or just a show about a street shooter.
Yeah.
Whatever those are.
Either. Street shooter.
I also had TV bloopers and practical jokes on there. That's a for sure.
That would have been my pick.
And I also put on Rockford Files just for the intro song because I love that theme so much. I would just go for the theme. The rest of the show, whatever.
I get the sheet music.
Oh, do you?
Yeah.
That was at 9 o'clock was Rockford Files?
It's a rerun at 9, yeah.
Okay.
So you're going Bloopers and Practical Jokes?
Yeah, I would have watched that the full hour. That was one of my favorite shows growing up.
I love that show so much because it was, you never got behind the scenes stuff.
You never got to see like bloopers of
being, yes, like
the people. Family ties people like screwing up on. Yep. I mean, that was so novel at that
time. I feel like that would, a lot of those would even hold up now. Like that,
probably. Yeah.
But do you remember, like, because that started as a series of specials?
Yeah.
And they didn't have enough bloopers to have a weekly show. So they padded that thing every week.
Oh, was this a weekly show? I thought this would have been a special.
This was when it was the weekly show. So they had like Len Sella's Silly Cinemas, and which this guy just made little 8mm films. They had Will Schreiner did a thing. They had people like Man on the Street things. They would do sketches sometimes. You have 2 minutes of bloopers this week.
Yeah, I get real deluded.
So this one is scheduled segments include practical jokes played on Ann Gillian and Christopher Atkins, bloopers from classic films, Robert Klein visiting popular New York City tourist spots, and commercials featuring monsters.
So, yeah.
What time of year is this?
Is this the definition?
January. Oh, this is January.
Yeah, January 30th. But I loved that show. It was just like, I mean, it was like a YouTube hole.
Yeah.
Do you remember the Stevie Wonder joke?
No.
They played a joke on Stevie Wonder.
Did they?
Oh, yeah.
What was the practical joke?
I believe they moved his furniture around.
No.
And I remember Dick Clark specifically going, for the first time, we didn't have to hide our cameras.
Because he's blind.
And he was all, Stevie Wonder was all like, huh. Like, he played along.
He didn't
along,
give it a good.
But, yeah, it's.
Can you imagine how horrifying it'd be to be blind?
Yeah. And then, like, they're playing jokes on you for TV.
Yeah.
For fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. There is, oh boy.
Well, there is the part in UHF where they're like, the practical joke, they have their own practical joke promo show, and it's like the camera guy sticks out his leg as an old lady's leaving with groceries, and she falls over, and everybody laughs.
Yeah.
And that's that much far from moving Stevie Wonder's furniture around.
No, I mean, that's pretty much the world we live in now.
Yeah.
But I also want to point out that Fairy Tale Theater is on at this time, which was Shelly Duval's
weird thing.
And we were talking about him earlier, I think, before we started recording. But this is Rumpelstiltskin. With star Shelley Duvall as the maiden, and Rumpelstiltskin's played by Herve Valechez.
Oh, really?
Oh.
Wow, yes. How about that?
I don't know that show.
It was for Showtime, and she made it. It was shot on video. Fairy Tales with pretty big name people. And it's really good. Like, there's an episode with Christopher Lee in it called The Boy Who Set Out to Find the Shivers. It's him and what's his name? The guy who plays in Ghostbusters 2 who gets possessed by Vigo.
Oh, yeah.
Curly hair.
I forgot his name. Yeah.
But there's also like The Nightingale starring Mick Jagger. And The Frog Prince starring Robin Williams.
Robin Williams, I remember that one. Yeah, yeah, we had the VHS tapes of it. So, yeah.
Was it like Amazing Stories kind of a thing? Or was
there hour-long things, or maybe it was half hour.
More low, but like it's shot on video, and it's like a play.
Yes, right.
Jack and the Beanstalk.
Cheap sets and things,
Gene Stapleton.
But different twists on Jack and the Beanstalk, or would they just tell the story of Jack and the Beanstalk?
They just pretty much tell the story, but like, you know, well, and with like celebrities.
Yeah.
But, nothing.
And it was a children's show?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
But it's kind of terrifying as well. Mm-hmm. Like, it was not really funny. It was, like, kind of just scary all the time. Yeah. Amazing Stories, I always wanted to like and always found disappointing.
Really?
Hmm.
Yeah. Oh, I always loved it.
Are you guys both big?
Yeah, I always looked forward to it. I haven't watched them since.
And that was a Sunday night show, too.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
The three that stand out to me is the one where Santa Claus gets trapped in the house because the burglar alarm goes off. And the cops have him surrounded. The Thanksgiving one with the well and those like creatures that eat things. Do you remember that one?
I don't remember any
that
of
one's,
them.
That one's really scary.
I remember where there's a World War II plane and they don't have
the cartoon.
They can't land, and so the cartoonist draws a wheel.
That's the pilot.
The pilot, who likes to draw cartoons. He draws a cartoon and the wheel actually becomes a real wheel on
Casey
the plane.
Casey Semetzko from 3 o'clock High plays that guy.
Oh, that's who played the guy?
Yeah, he's the belly gunner. Yeah, but it just didn't. Because I was a big Twilight Zone guy, and Amazing Stories always seemed like
it's the Spielberg version. It's a lot less dark.
I'm like, like someone saw Twilight Zone the movie and was like, "Man, I wish this was all Kick the Can."
Yeah, yeah.
Like, no, we don't want all Kick the Can. Where are we? Monday night. We went there at 9 o'clock. What'd you guys go with?
I went with that. I didn't even know what this was, but Bits Buzzword sounds like a game show, but I don't know what that is.
This is a ripoff of TV's Bloopers and Practical Jokes.
Oh, well, then I chose wisely.
Yeah.
There were two ripoffs. One was called Follow Ups, Bleeps, and Blunders, which was hosted by Don Rickles. And this was Bits, Bites, and Buzzwords. And it was more of like a technology-focused one. And it was a PBS show. And they were trying to do like a humorous PBS show.
Yeah, good luck with that.
It is not good.
No?
Not good, yeah.
Well, on Tuesday night, though, I did do Phelps, Bleeps, and Blunders.
I did as well.
Okay. Yeah.
So that's another. So there were like three different blooper shows on at the
same
time.
They were so popular.
Yeah,
and
cheap to produce, I imagine. Yeah.
And there was also like the world. Oh, there was one called... it was hosted by Steve Allen, and it was called Life's Most Embarrassing Moments, but it was just like a blooper show.
Right.
Which is another reason why they had trouble getting bloopers every week, because they were now a hot commodity.
they're fighting over bloopers.
The blooper wars of the 80s.
Well, do you know what bloopers were called before they were called bloopers?
Blunders? Hold on. Goofs?
Boners.
Oh, boners.
Right. And the guy who invented the boner, as they used to say, used to do books of radio bloopers. And they were transcriptions of bloopers that he had heard on live radio.
He could have made up stuff.
People think he might have.
Yeah.
But there's tons and tons of books. You can find them. Like, they're always at thrift stores. But it's hilarious. People are like, "You guys want to read some bloopers? Let's read some boners." So it was like, "I heard this guy say the wrong word once. I wrote it down." And now people are going to buy it and read it. Oh, the internet.
That's a terrible idea.
I know. There's a made-for-TV movie here. This isn't a made-for-TV movie. The Most Beautiful Girl in the World pageant.
I did see that on there.
Oh, I must have missed that one.
This is a 1 year only. This was a beauty pageant with a twist. Viewers determine the winner. So this was a vote-in. David Hasselhoff and Jane Kennedy are the hosts. And Honolulu, where judges grade 21 international contestants on grace, poise, carriage, personality, and physical beauty.
Carriage.
When the field is narrowed to three, viewers in areas showing the program live may phone in their favorite contestant at a cost of 50 cents per call. Entertainment is slated to be provided by Air Supply and Engelbert Humperdinck.
Ooh, wow.
Together at last.
Is it too late to change my answer here?
Finally.
I'm switching to that.
Yeah.
I am.
Yeah.
I don't know if Monday night.
I don't know if it was theirs to play fronted by Engelbert Humperdinck, but that, I mean, I'd go see that.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. And then Newhart 930, like that's...
I had that everything. On there.
Yeah.
That was one of my favorites.
I still watch that almost every week and love Newhart.
It holds
so
up. Well.
It's so funny.
It's pretty timeless, isn't it?
It's totally timeless and so funny. And where you get a life, fans?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
The final three seasons of Newhart is literally the entire writing staff of Get a Life, like David Merkin. And so it's basically Get a Life the last season. It's really bizarre. Like, there's an episode where George gets his old high school gang back together. And so these old guys have a gang and they have like gang jackets and they rumble with this other old guy gang.
It sounds like a Get a Life.
It got wacky.
Get a Life. Yeah. And like Michael and Stephanie's daughter, who's a baby, gets left the television station. So this baby's in charge of the television. Like, it's crazy. It is completely crazy.
Yeah.
But it's really funny and weird.
Oh, I'm gonna have to watch some.
It's yeah.
What did you say? The last three seasons?
Yeah, the last. Okay. Well, yeah, the third to last gets a little weird, and then the last two are just like out and out bonkers.
Yeah.
Which is why that famous reveal of like it was all a dream, like actually makes
it kind of made
more
sense. Yeah, he's still in.
It does.
Yeah.
Charlie Kaufman wasn't he on? Was Charlie Kaufman?
Charlie Kaufman was on Get a Life, so he wasn't in Newhart, but like Mary Gross,
and, Golden Girls, right?
Yes, Golden Girls, yeah. And so like half the Get a Life writers went right from Newhart to Get a Life, and it's you can really tell.
Yeah.
It, definitely you can tell, and it's such a weird show. And this one is Dick's guest stint on a book and author show leads him to bigger but not necessarily better things as the program's new host. This one's hilarious. He tries to do like a late night talk show, but like a Johnny Carson type talk show, and it's really terrible and funny. And
is this part of the season with all those writers? Or?
No, this is earlier.
Oh, this is earlier.
Okay.
This is like season three.
Okay.
Yeah, that show has Jonathan Katz has told me his favorite joke of a sitcom of all time is in a Newhart episode, and it's Melanie Chartoff plays this therapist for Michael and Stephanie, and she goes, "Michael, I'm afraid I can't see you anymore." And he goes, "Why?" And she goes, "Because of my feelings for you." And he goes, "Oh, I knew it. You hate me." And she goes, "No, it's very much the opposite." And he goes, "I hate you." And she's like, no. It's just such like a perfect
that sounds like
joke.
A Jonathan Katz like joke.
Oh,
too.
It's a perfect
therapist. Yeah.
It's very funny. Where are we? Tuesday at 8?
I think we both went with
follow-ups, bleeps, and blunders.
I wonder if back then, like on shows, that they would try to do more bloopers.
I wonder if they got a note from a producer.
To like get bloopers?
You got a mosquito up on your forehead.
Oh,
yeah.
Geez.
Yeah. All right. He's gone. You're okay.
Yeah. We are recording in a tent, everybody.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
What did you do for 8:30?
Huh?
Oh, sorry. You were talking about blunders?
I wonder if they got a note from producers saying, you guys got to screw up more often.
They had to. Because some of them definitely don't seem natural sometimes.
Yeah.
But I love news bloopers. Like, that's
it's my favorite thing in the world.
Ever.
Yeah.
Actually, one of the funniest ones I've ever seen, I think it was like an extra on one of your DVDs with the guy talking about the guy being dead and he's 72 degrees.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
He says it again.
It's from Athens, Georgia.
Yeah.
I love it. I love it. And those news be funny, every month on YouTube.
Yeah. And they're always like 17 minutes long, and I watch the entire thing.
Over
and they could be
and over
longer.
Again.
They could be longer.
I laugh so, like, I hurt myself.
Yeah.
We did a show in Fargo, North Dakota last year. And a guy came up to us who had worked in local news for 20 years. He was an editor and he was a director and he did tons of stuff. And he hated the job, but he loved the bloopers. He told us this. He's like, I was in it for the bloopers. He's like, that's the only reason I stuck around. And he handed us this hard drive with 20 years worth of untouched news bloopers. And we're actually featuring it in our show tonight. It kicks the show off because it's so good.
That's just amazing.
You can't go wrong.
It's people who aren't really funny having to ad lib.
Yeah.
And it's just nuts. And like every time I go to L.A., I swear, I kind of jokingly say this, but it's true. I just want to watch Good Day LA because it's a nightmare mess of craziness.
Yeah.
And I'm like, I can't believe this is every day of just like them screwing up. No one knows what's going on. There's just craziness.
Yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. Now, there was a show in Milwaukee called Breakfast Blend or something like that.
Yeah,
and it was these two women were just, they sucked so bad. And they just didn't know how to improvise and they couldn't, but I'd watch it every single morning.
Have you seen the one from Hawaii with the martial arts demonstration? There's like,
no.
There's this guy who's like, they're doing a big martial arts demonstration and the guy breaks a brick. And they have a bunch set up. And then the host of the show goes, man, he really just broke that. This is a real brick. And picks it up and just breaks in half. and he looks at the guy and the guy starts laughing and then they're like, and then he has to continue with the segment.
No.
And he's like, but these ones are real. And the guy's like, yes, these are real. And then they can't stop laughing. But this guy just totally got totally busted for like, it's very,
they
funny.
Have to play it straight. Yeah. Yeah.
They should sue that guy then.
They should.
They should. Yeah.
I think they should. Yes, you guys have much experience with people. Yeah. Mm-hmm. We don't need to get into that. Okay. Sorry to bring it up, everyone. But on follow-ups, bleeps and blunders that night, they do a thing that TV Guide does that I love where they say scheduled. Because they don't want to commit to anything.
Right.
So don't get mad at them if this isn't what's on.
Okay. Oh, really?
So they say scheduled Missy Gold from Benson and Randolph Mantooth, which is one of the best actor names ever, from Emergency. also, clips of Steve Martin, Arthur Hill, and Robert Guillaume.
Oh, I would like to see all those, actually. Yeah.
I enjoyed that show. Love a blooper.
All right, good decision there at 8 o'clock.
8:30?
So I kind of did this one a little bit weird because I'm flipping around because I see a lot of stuff I want to watch, but I'm not really married to anything.
Right, right.
And I'm a flipper. I like flipping and seeing 3 seconds of things. I put George Burns, An Hour of Jokes and Songs on there. I
saw that too, yeah.
I just want to turn there for 5 minutes, see what's going on.
Yeah.
Three's Company I have. I just want to see what's going on. I don't want to watch
final
the whole
season of Three's Company before it came Three's a Crowd.
Oh, really?
Mm. Yep.
Okay.
Yep.
And then the Terry Fox story. Which I, that sounds Fox vaguely story. Familiar. That was another
some
I
think, rip from the headlines thing, maybe.
Yeah. The one with the guy who ran across the United States. Do you remember that one?
Oh,
with the guy
with
did he have a
artificial leg?
Artificial
or
leg. That's what
was
I
was that Terry Fox? Hmm.
Where's the Terry Fox story? I'm trying to see what where it is in here because I'm curious now. Heart to Heart is an Olympic crossover.
Oh, yeah, 84.
Which is pretty exciting.
I went with Nova at 8:30 just because I was like, maybe after follow-ups, bleeps, and blunders, you want a little bit of educational content.
Yeah.
So I thought, as a kid, there's no way I would have watched Nova, but now, maybe.
What was the Nova episode about?
I didn't even see the episode.
1961, 12 nations signed a treaty opening up Antarctica, Earth's last frontier.
That could be cool.
Maybe.
But that's not maybe not.
But you know George Burns, An Hour of Jokes.
I know. I probably that's where I would have been.
The former vaudevillian's nightclub act includes songs, jokes, and stories. I don't know why they felt the need to describe it as such, given that that's literally what the title of the
show
is.
I know. You know it.
It's not like a misdirect.
Yeah.
He just plays cards the whole time. And they don't give us any description of the movie.
Fox story?
The Terry Fox story.
No?
Nothing. Hmm. They just said the Terry Fox story like you
doesn't it
know.
Sound familiar, though?
It does.
Yeah.
I feel like it
was
something.
Yeah.
I think it's the guy who ran across the United States.
SCTV's on Cinemax at that time.
That as written. It's like past prime time, but
this is the Cinemax, the final season, and it's so weird that season.
Really?
It was like just the core group of people, so it's just Levy, Flaherty, and
Andrew Martin.
And it is real bizarre.
Would they swear? Would they have nudity or anything?
No,
they're on Cinemax.
They didn't need to.
Really?
It just got weird. They did a whole, and Martin Short, they did a whole hour long episode that was a mashup of Das Boot and Porky's called Das Booty, and it's like that's the only sketch.
Yeah,
and it's crazy. They just were like, we could do whatever, and the episodes weren't of like a certain length or anything.
Oh yeah, they could
like,
just
Cinemax let them do whatever they want, and it got really weird.
Wow.
Yeah, it's great. Soren Weiss Report was big on that one, if you remember those characters.
No.
It was Eugene Levy and Martin Short, and they were like these catty, like Rex Reed type guys.
Oh, yeah.
But they would just review everything, and they would just say things back and forth. Like, he's like, Soviet Union. And he goes, hate it. Like, and he's like, one thing he goes, acid rain. He goes, oh, yeah. And then they just move on to the next thing. It's really bizarre. I love SCTV. That's my everything. Wednesday night, what'd you go with?
I love Wednesday night here. This is a fun night.
The best night of the week?
Well, not necessarily, but this and this particular week it was for TV. I put Real People just to kick things off.
Yeah. I had that as well.
Yeah. But then Man with Two Brains was on.
Oh, that's
something
I didn't see
flip over to. And then after Man with Two Brains, it just said Steve Martin. And I looked it up in the description. It's Absent-Minded Waiter. They're playing Absent-Minded Waiter.
They just played the short film after.
Yeah.
I missed that.
We
were doing
some weird stuff on TV when we were growing up.
Yeah.
But they were just like, sure.
But that was the age where I think I learned about Steve Martin. Because I remember he was on a Muppet Babies episode.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. And I remember that was the first time I ever saw him. And I think he had the arrow through the head. And I was like, he's hilarious.
Muppet
and I wanted
Babies.
To find out more.
I saw him on the Muppet Show because our family watched that a lot. So, yeah.
Muppet Babies 100% holds up, I will add.
Does it really?
It's really funny and smart. And I actually like it, I think, in some ways better than the Muppet Show.
Really?
Because they could do more. Like, and it's just really good.
Yeah.
It's really good. Do you remember what that started as?
What?
It was Muppet Babies and Little Muppet Monsters. And it was an hour long, and half hour was these Little Muppet Monsters, which was live action, and the Muppet Babies was the cartoon, and they cut the Muppet Monsters after three episodes. And the only remnants of it is in the closing credits. It went like the Muppet Babies theme song that we all know.
Yep.
Yeah.
But in the closing credits version, there's a part where after it goes Muppet Babies, and then it goes Little Muppet Monsters, and it's
That's still in the closing credits.
Yeah.
Oh, but they kept that in.
I have no recollection of that at all.
What did Animal say? Did they say Animal Pie or
go
Animal
bye
Dance?
Bye.
Oh,
Animal Dance.
Dance.
Yeah. Animal Dance.
Yeah. Okay. Dance.
I was saying Animal Pie.
Everything all right in here? Yes. Yeah. I love that show. But then that started that weird trend of the baby. Babification of every cartoon ever.
Oh, yeah,
Flintstone Kids and
Mr. Potato Head Kids. That was
no.
one. Yeah, they even had a deal with Burger King to have toys. And there was a Pink Panther and Sons.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That was a weird one. Yeah, there was a lot of just children.
Babies of everything,
Yeah, I don't know why that was. And a pup named Scooby Doo.
Oh, right.
That's right.
Yeah.
It got weird. So this episode of Real People segments include a revolution of, what does that say? A reunion of Batan Death March survivors in Montgomery, Alabama.
Oh, kids, come in.
Body language expert Iris Shelton, Sarah Purcell in a water ski ballet, California Highway Patrol partners who are married, and a fashion show for dogs.
Wow.
This is all.
You got to sit through the Batan March reunion.
Batan Death March.
To get to the dog fashion show.
Fashion show
same
for
episode
dogs.
In the same episode.
Yeah.
Oh.
As a kid, you're just like, oh, keep like you just have to keep waiting for the next segment until the dog fashion show comes on.
But like, I am speechless about that. That's
you got to find that episode.
Yeah, I
bet they bookended it that way. They probably kicked it off with the Batan Death March.
Yes. And then later, watch these Dalmatians. Yes. You know,
that's always the one where like. And the sitcoms do this too. They'd have the sad version of their theme song.
Yes.
And these real like they must have like gone to the commercial on the sad version and then come back with like the dog fashion show version. we gotta follow the Batan Death March survivors.
Yeah.
Yes, you do. In the dog fashion show. So you both went with that.
Yeah. Yep. Real people. 100%.
What did you? What else did you have on Wednesday night?
Facts of Life and Night Court. That would have been my go-to's sitcoms. Night Court, I loved.
And that was the whole
first
family.
Season Night Court. Also, Barney Miller, alum.
Yeah.
Of that show.
Yeah, I was into magic, so I liked Harry Anderson. I loved Bull, of course.
Wasn't that kind of a dirty show, though?
Yeah, Larroquette was a little dirty. So there's some parts where he was, you know, harassing Marky Post or whatever I was a little uncomfortable
what
with.
What would you do when there's like a dirty part?
Just pretend not to know what it meant, you know?
Yeah, your family was just always just ignore it kind of thing.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
Well, they're always, in hindsight, because I'll rewatch that show and I still enjoy it, but a lot of the sexual stuff is written in a way that it's like a 12-year-old who doesn't know what sex is, right? Now, I realize because it'd be like, Dan, what are you doing? He's like, I have handcuffs and peanut butter. And you're like, what?
Yeah.
And like as a kid,
it's
you're
what
like,
a kid thinks adults do.
Adults do like weird kinky stuff with like, with thermometers or something.
Yeah,
like,
But your dad had a master move that he would do whenever there's a dirty part though.
Well, I think like he would change the channel if something dirty came up and like pretend the remote had slipped
like
but Airplane specifically. You told the story about Airplane when
I think
when
we were all watching
breasts.
Airplane once and I knew where the bare breasts were in that movie and it was me, my mom, and my sister all watching it, and this was like I think I was in college. I mean, this was like
isn't when you were
this isn't when I was a kid,
but it's still just
but it's still as awkward. So and then it was like I think the remote flipped, because we were watching it on TV, and the remote flipped to another channel, and we're like, Dad, what are you doing? And I'm like, I know what you're doing.
Yeah.
I thank you for it, because I didn't want to be there while jiggling breasts were on the screen with my mom and sister in the room. So thank you.
I built black boxes at our house when I was a kid. I got plans out of Maximum Rock and Roll magazine and went to Radio Shack, and I built black boxes. So we got all the channels, but I put a parental lock code on it.
Yeah.
So my dad would have to come to me if he wanted to watch.
Really?
Like the Playboy channel or anything.
Oh,
I was like 13. It was such a power move. And I would go like, what are you watching? No, I just want to see if it works. And so one time, and then he wouldn't watch it. But one time, this must have been like the most humiliating thing for him in hindsight. He goes, Foxy Boxing.
Horny divorced dad.
Yeah, it was Foxy Boxing.
All right, Dad, the code's 1, 2, 3, yeah, 4. Yeah, go
it's
nuts. Like,
it's your birthday.
Yeah.
On there. Yeah, Foxy Boxing. Facts of Life, this is pre-Clooney. Mm-hmm. My favorite era of Facts of Life is the last three seasons when they open over our heads, which I just wanted to live in. But this is, the girls are shaken by the sudden death of Natalie's father and wonder how to ease her pain. And this is the one where she finds out that her dad had a second family.
Oh, God.
Like, he had, like, a secret wife and, like, all this stuff.
It's very heavy. They wouldn't do these on children's shows now, I don't think.
But that was a live studio audience, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So they
had,
like, a laugh track and everything.
Yeah.
Like, if during a serious part, would they do, like, oh?
Yeah.
Would they do that?
Yeah. Do you know who was the warm-up comic for that show for the whole run? Paul Prevenza.
Oh, yeah.
The entire run of Facts of Life.
No, good gig.
The one episode that I think is, like, the heaviest one is where Tootie almost gets turned into a prostitute. Remember that one?
No.
They go into New York City to go to a Broadway show, and she is at like a diner across the street, and this like teenage prostitute is like, yeah, well, why don't you come on with me? And my friend, he's a real nice guy. And it's this like sleazy, it's like, hey, Tootie, you got the look. And then the prostitute's like, don't go with him. He's going to make you a prostitute. And she's like, what? He's going to help me be an actress. And it's like this, and it's just really creepy. And no reason.
Very special episode.
Yeah. Oh, completely. Yeah. 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 But it's a good one.
When did they say very special episode? Was that like in the previous part? They'd say next on a very
They'd be like, and Sunday on a very special Silver Spoons, which they had as well. There was a teen pregnancy one that was fantastic.
Yeah. I always remember being a little bit disappointed if it was a very special.
Yeah.
It was like, oh, can't it just be, you know. He goes to space camp or something, yeah, you know, like
Mr. T guest star.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's what you wanted. Yeah.
Do they still have very special episodes on like contemporary TV shows like Big Bang Theory or anything?
I don't think so. Because they don't broadcast anymore. They're so narrowcast in that the genre of sitcoms that we grew up with has really become like That's So Raven, you know, like the Disney Channel kind of things.
Right.
And they're so silly. Like they don't tackle anything. So they kind of split them into like very adult or like very kiddie.
Yeah.
There's no weird crossover anymore. And do you remember the Christmas very special Silver Spoons?
No.
A young Joey Lawrence?
No.
So the Stratton's very rich, obviously. Sorry if I'm going on and on here.
No, I know. I love the Stratton's.
So Joey Lawrence, young scamp Joey Lawrence and his bowl cut comes into like, he's selling something for charity as the pretense, but he actually breaks in and steals all their presents, which happens frequently.
Right.
So he's a poor kid, I assume.
Street urchin stealing presents. Yep.
So Ricky follows him and finds out that he's living in a cave on the Stratton's property with his family because his father was laid off. Now, Mr. Stratton owns a company, and they're very rich.
Okay.
So instead of giving him a job, when they go out, Ricky sneaks in and decorates their cave.
Oh, wow.
With like a tree and stuff.
I have some questions about the cave.
Yeah.
Did you ever see, like, how did they do that production-wise? Did you see the exterior of it?
No. It's real Land of the Lost looking like styrofoam cave. It's very much like, did you remember the two-part Perils of Punky Brewster cave episode?
No.
They
no,
get stuck in a cave with an evil Indian spirit who tries to kill them all.
Did an 8-year-old write that one too?
I think that might have been an old man who wrote that one. But that one's the one that like completely traumatized the generation of people because there's like decapitated Cherry and Margot turns into a skeleton. Yeah.
Good it's, Lord.
Yeah. There's a... Alan turns, they have like a jello mold face version of Alan with like a green mouth foaming and he's going like Punky and all this stuff's coming out of his face.
And insane.
They don't warn you at all. Yeah.
It's just madness.
I used to do a thing on, I used to do a live show, and I did a segment called TV Casualty. And the premise was like something that you saw as a kid that was not a horror thing. It was not intended to terrify you, but it's just like scarred you. And that one always came up. There was one guy was really terrorized by the Wide World of Sports Agony of Defeat guy. It was like a ski wipeout that's just brutal. And it really freaked him out like as a kid. I feel like everyone had one of those.
Yeah, I'm trying to think what I had. You know what I had was the Bermuda Triangle.
Yeah.
That scared me so bad. I would be up at night being worried about the Bermuda Triangle.
Did you ever have to travel that?
No, yeah. Not at all. I was living in a small town in Wisconsin. But I pictured myself, I was like, what if I like raise up right now and shoot over to the Bermuda Triangle?
Yeah, like you're just going to get kidnapped.
Yeah.
Were you like an In Search Of, terrified by like Chariots of the Gods kid and all that stuff? Like the Man Who Saw Tomorrow and all those kind of things.
No, I don't know. I don't know what it was, but I just, the Bermuda Triangle just freaked me out. And that was probably around this era, 84. Yeah. They loved the Bermuda Triangle.
It was
then.
Huge. Did it just go away? Because I never hear about it anymore.
No,
it's like acid rain.
Yeah.
It's just gone.
Yeah.
No one cares.
Yeah.
Yeah. All the acid rains in the Bermuda. Did you have something as a kid that wasn't intended to terrify you, but was like absolutely haunting?
From TV?
Yeah.
You know, actually, the one show that I actually kind of had to sneak to watch that was a drama slash action show was The Hulk.
Yeah.
And I wasn't scared, but I was disturbed by how the ending, he just never had a home and would just be walking along the road sad. And he had no connection to anybody, and that really disturbed me.
It was never
me.
An uplifting ending.
No.
It was never...
Are you familiar with the Hulk cult list?
The what?
A guy watched every episode of The Hulk and made a list of everything that causes him to Hulk out in the whole series.
Oh.
And it's not embellished in any way.
Mm-hmm.
It is just a... It is one of the funniest things I've ever written, because it's like, crushed by a boulder, no change for the telephone, thrown off a bridge. Like, it's just this matter
the gamut
of fact,
what?
Hulk out list.
Wow.
And Ken Johnson, that created that show, someone emailed it to him and he put it up on his website.
Oh, yeah?
And it's just this
that's
like,
really
Excel
funny.
Grid sheet of everything that caused him to Hulk out.
Well, I loved The Hulk as a kid, and so like I was like, oh, cool, the show is going to be the realization of me wanting to be super strong and all this stuff. And then I was like, oh, no, it's this disturbing man who can't find a home or a family.
And for Rigno's terrifying, too.
Yeah.
Like, The Hulk... I've told this, I think I told this on my album before, but I watched The Hulk because I was a big comic book fan. It was all we had. And Spider-Man is amazing friends, but like we didn't have any live action stuff. And I was terrified of The Hulk though. And my parents somehow misinterpreted this to mean I like really loved The Hulk. So for my second birthday, they got one of my uncle's buddies who was a bodybuilder to paint himself green and like crash my birthday party. And I freaked out because I'm two. And it, like, you're surprising me with a monster.
Yeah, that's what it is.
Into the bed, and they were like, so ungrateful.
Oh, God.
Like, they just didn't get that. That was absolutely traumatic and terrifying.
I went as the Hulk one year. I was just a skinny little kid, and I have pictures
Grained
of it. Just,
yourself
yeah.
Up?
It was probably just toxic paint.
Oh, yeah. You know? I bet.
Yeah. Yeah.
Ripped pants.
Yeah, but then I'm walking around in, you know, October 31st in Wisconsin with just tiny shorts on.
Yeah.
Oh, I just had the plastic mask Hulk costume.
The Ben
Cooper
costume.
Yeah,
Ben
Cooper.
I wasn't going to do that. I wanted to go green skin.
Yeah. Right.
I never got a Ben Cooper costume, but I always wanted, like, even though they're the worst, there's a garbage bag and a mask.
And the mask would cut your lip when, you know.
But they had the coolest licenses. Like, you know, it could be whatever it was.
Yep.
So that's all Wednesday night. Did you pick your 9 o'clock? Did we say
Facts Life Night Court was
Night
me.
Court, and then
Man with Two Brains. Steve
Martin, right.
Showtime show.
Yeah, I think I'm. Real people. I would have gone with that.
The Night Court episode. Speaking of it being dirty, this is brought before the court a lonely woman who seems to know the details of Harry's life and claims to be his long lost mother and the sleazy promoter of a beauty contest. Maybe it's that one that Hasselhoff was hosting with Harrison.
Yeah,
right on schedule. Yeah. That sounds like a Night Court.
They could still call them beauty contests back then too.
Yes. Oh yeah. I used to watch those. Like
my mom would always watch them.
Watch them. Yeah. I don't know why. Like
pretty girls.
Yes.
I don't know.
Yeah. It just felt like an event, though.
Yeah, it was.
Exciting.
Yeah,
it was like
a special
Super Bowl or something. Yeah. You know.
It was live usually.
Everybody.
Yeah,
it was water cooler.
Yeah. You get John Davidson's gonna sing some tunes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
You never know.
Wait, was he the Hollywood Squares guy, John Davidson?
Yes. Yeah.
He sang.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah.
Oh, I didn't know he sang.
Yeah. It was like he was one of those guys that was a lot like what's the Bert Convy. where you're like, I don't know why anyone has them on anything, but apparently they sing and are in Love Boat and host a game show.
Yeah, yeah.
Just didn't like everything for yeah. no apparent reason.
Well, Alan Thicke was sort of like that, too. Yeah, actor, too. Game show host, yeah, and yeah. singer, yeah.
Did you remember when Thick of the Night started, how they advertised that?
No.
SCTV actually parodied this in the Cinemax season by having Sammy Modlin do a Thick of the Night kind of show, but the ads were literally, look out, Johnny. It was all like, this is the new generation, and it was all supposed to be
Alan Thicke.
Yeah. And the Modlin of the Night one's great because he has this crew of comedians he calls his zanies. And one of them is Martin Short basically being Howie Mandel. And he's like, now this guy, he's a master of improv. And he's never seen any of these objects. And it's Martin Short going, okay, just nothing. And he's like, if you don't have anything, it's fine. Just tell me. And it's, but it's like,
he just clams up.
Yeah, and he's going,
that's such a Martin yeah. Short
oh,
character.
It's so funny.
That's great.
And everyone's like, it's okay. If you don't have anything, it's okay. It's just, we're good. It's very funny.
Helping him through it. Yeah.
And yeah, look out, Johnny. And it was really like, you're going down. And then that show lasted less than 6 months.
Oh, yeah.
But that's how we got Growing Pains.
Oh, yeah. from Thick of the Night, really?
Oh, really?
I recently learned that Alan Thicke's first wife is the one who co-wrote the Facts of Life and Different Strokes theme song with him. And she sings that song, Friends and Lovers. It was like a duet in like 85.
Like a radio
yeah.
hit?
Yeah, and it wasn't how can we be lovers if we can't be, but it was like, I can't remember how it goes now, but it's like some really...
We would recognize
like,
it.
Yeah,
if
oh,
we
yeah, 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 yeah. That's his ex-wife, and she wrote those two songs with
okay.
him. And then when they got divorced, he didn't write any more TV
That's true.
Songs, curiously.
Yeah, interesting.
Brains behind that operation.
Yeah. I wonder who was... Yeah. Yeah, all right.
Almost had him on the show, and then he passed away.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
Wow.
Was emailing with him that week.
Oh, man.
My fault. Hey. Yeah. Thursday night, 8 o'clock.
You want to start?
Yep. Give me a break. Nell gets hypnotized. I mean, say no more.
Yeah.
That's right up my...
Yep.
I would have been like an 8, 9 here. So, yeah, that's...
Was that appointment television for you?
Oh, yeah.
It was for me. Yeah. I love
Family Ties, Give Me a Break. Yep.
Was there a better angry character on a show than Dolph Sweet, the chief?
Oh, yeah, that's right. I was actually trying to remember the details of Gimme Life. All I remember is Nell, and then was it not Joey Lawrence, but...
Joey Lawrence was later.
He was later, but...
Which they have the infamous Al Jolson episode. You remember that?
Yeah, yeah.
Whole boy.
Ooh, yeah.
Yowza.
Yeah, Joey Lawrence in blackface.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. But it was Dolph Sweet, and Nell was his... wife's best friend, and his wife died, and as part of her will basically was like, you gotta live with my family.
So that's why she wasn't the housekeeper. She was like
okay, but also it was like something about being a friend.
Yeah,
but there was all these shows in the 80s that I'm like, here's the show they wanted to make.
Yeah,
like, let's make a show about an interracial couple, let's make a show about two gay dads.
Yeah,
but instead they were like, let's have some silly conceit.
Yeah, so there's a death or yeah. Somebody's a yeah.
Like, my two dads, I'm always like, it was better for them to go, look, this woman had sex with these two dudes, like, same night. And they don't know who the dad is. So they both raise them. They're like, that's fine. They can't be like...
They can't be gay.
Two guys love each other, and they have a daughter.
Yeah.
Get out of here.
And they're different. Yeah, 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 no, that yeah. would never...
Well, like, Brady Bunch, what was that? That was like... They never explained that one.
No,
either, though,
they didn't
did
explain
they?
If they died or it was divorced
right.
or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah.
No one asked. No one asked questions.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Very strange.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I always wanted like the exes to show up.
Yeah.
That would have been yeah. a good episode. Yeah.
Although the second Brady Bunch movie did touch on that. They had Tim from Animal House. Tim Matheson.
Mazursky? Oh.
Tim
yeah.
Matheson pretend to be her long lost husband. And then he was trying to kill her to like get their money or something.
So this is a
like
very Brady sequel, like
yeah,
the recent
yeah,
ones.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. Which is actually really funny.
I remember them
yeah.
being funny, actually.
Yeah. yeah.
I was expecting
great.
The worst, and they turned up pretty
they
good.
Great. Yeah,
what?
Yeah.
Now, you weren't all sitcom watchers, so what did you have for the 8 o'clock hour?
I had trouble with 8 o'clock. I put Magnum P.I. just because
okay.
I think my parents watched that one, and I would just kind of sit in sometimes.
Carol Burnett is guest starring on this episode of Magnum P.I.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
She plays a woman who suspects her recently paroled father, a counterfeiter, is back in business.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I would
yeah.
have.
All right. Sounds
seems like
right.
some of my parents would watch.
Yeah.
Family Ties, of course, I had that.
Yeah,
that
we both
was,
had that.
The whole family was
that
there
show.
For that one. Then I did Cheers. Got to do Cheers.
Yep, like, I did too.
The whole NBC lineup?
Huh?
You went the whole NBC lineup?
Yeah. I did too. I even went Buffalo Bill because I remember we watched that show for a while.
What was that show? I have no idea what
it was. It was Dabney Coleman, and it was a news set in the news, wasn't it?
Yeah, he was the news anchor, and he was like a real asshole.
Yeah.
Wow. And it was one of the first shows I remember where the lead character was unlikable.
Yes, he was a jerk. Yeah.
It wasn't like, he's misunderstood. It was like, no, he's an asshole.
Yeah.
Like, and Gene Davis was in it.
Oh, really? Yeah. Okay.
She was like his foil.
Yeah.
And people hated it. Hated it. Because it was
unpleasant.
Yeah, it was way ahead of its time.
Yeah. But Archie Bunker, I guess he was a unlikable.
But I think with Archie Bunker, there was a lot of people who watched it wrong in that they thought it was like a pro Archie Bunker show.
Oh.
He says the stuff we're all thinking.
Right.
Yeah.
And Buffalo Bill couldn't watch it that way. Like, it was presented in a way where you were just like, yeah, he's the worst person.
Right.
And it was a great show. You can get the whole show on DVD for like $4 now, and it's like worth watching.
It's
I should revisit it. Yeah.
Is it a funny show or
it's
is
funny,
it?
Funny. Yeah, it's a sitcom. Okay. But it's really smart and kind of dark and stands out.
Yeah. I just watched 9 to 5 recently. I didn't realize how funny Dabney Coleman actually is.
Oh, he's great.
Yeah.
He's funny.
He was in the Muppet movie, one of the Muppet movies.
He's Jack Flack and Cloak and Dagger.
Yeah. Yeah, he was great.
No, he's funny.
It seems like Old Times that he's in? No, it's Modern Problems. Speaking of Nell Carter. Where she's the voodoo housekeeper and Chevy Chase is psychic because he gets toxic waste dumped on him.
I remember renting that one day. Yeah.
That one is that's a weird one.
I missed that one somehow.
He goes to a ballet and makes their crotches explode. That was what I
You're just making
saying.
It up now, aren't you?
Yeah. Yeah.
This is my Chevy Chase fan fiction that I write. Where Dabney Coleman's like the villain in it. It's really good.
I also had Cannon on there. Just
Cannon, William Conrad.
Yeah.
Yeah. I never liked Cannon.
No, I didn't either. I needed to put something I don't know.
That's something if we were in a hotel on like a Saturday and Cannon came on, we'd probably watch it just to like see what it was all
just
about.
Just like, or on a flight to France or something.
He seems like a weird like lead, doesn't he? He was a fat, bald guy.
And he would show up in comedy. Like, you know what he would always be on is the Donny and Marie variety shows?
Mm.
Doing like sketches and silent comedians. And he'd sing and all this
stuff. Was he a stand-up or something?
No,
or was
he was just a dramatic actor. It was really weird.
Yeah.
And he's the one actor who I feel bad that when they put him in Jake and the Fat Man.
Right.
Yes.
I was like, how did that?
Because he was the Fat Man, right?
Yeah. They're like, he's like, so presumably I'm Jake. Be like,
There had to be a kind of weird conversation there. Yeah.
They're like, or they just gave him scripts with a different title.
Right.
Canon 2. Okay.
Yeah.
The Fat Man.
The Fat Man.
Which wasn't a bad show. But yeah, poor guy.
Was it a spinoff of Cannon?
No. It was just a new show, but he played a very Cannon-like character on it. I do want to mention 10 o'clock 2020 is on, which is literally the only show my parents didn't allow me to watch.
Oh, too adult, huh?
I bet you they had Bermuda Triangle stories on there, too.
And I was, anything I would see on there, I would be terrified of. So I was like, don't use lap seatbelts, don't use that ATM.
It was all expose stuff. Yeah.
Do you remember when they showed an exorcism on 2020?
I vaguely remember that.
I was terrified of that when it was on. And it's clearly I'm just a kid with mental illness. And I've rewatched it. Someone's put him up on YouTube. And the first time I watched it, I was like, this is so stupid. And then I watched it again, and I was like, I'm terrified of this again.
Yeah.
It was just
creepy. So good at scaring people.
Oh, yeah.
And you know what else I remember? I remember another thing that horrified me were those like UNICEF commercials, or the ones with the Ethiopian kids that would have the flies all over their head.
And the big distended.
Yes, that would always scare me too. Yeah.
Yeah. And PSAs terrified me.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, all the PSAs. There's one where the drug dealer turns into a snake. There was one, and I haven't been able to find this one. It was about AIDS, and it's a slow zoom into a hospital bed, and there's a guy in the bed, and it's like a net voiceover about AIDS, and the camera starts like panning around the bed, and then right before the end of the commercial, the guy jumps up and like reaches towards the camera, and it like freeze frames, and then it's like AIDS or whatever, and it's still like it gives me shivers thinking about it.
Yeah, it sounds terrifying.
Last night of the week, Friday night.
Final night. I kicked it off with Benson.
I did too, actually,
He's a pretty good one to kick it off with.
Ken, would you read the description of Friday's Benson? I think we'll all get a kick out of this because I wrote it down.
So first of all, I do want to say you guys skipped Leg Men, the adventure series.
I noticed the title, but I didn't know what it was.
I don't know what that is
either.
It was
John Terlersky and Bruce Greenwood, and it's like basically a show with two Magnum P.I.s.
Okay.
Right. Well, isn't that Heart to Heart?
But that was a married couple.
Oh, well, right. Yeah, we're Simon and Simon, I mean.
Yeah, they were brothers.
Yeah. Yeah.
So Benson that night, as a judge from the Miss Capital City beauty pageant.
Another beauty pageant thing.
Benson is being pressured by the governor and Clayton into voting for their favorite contestants. Yeah, this was just huge at this point.
Yeah.
I always loved his sexual tension with Krause.
Yeah, I did too.
It's always weird.
Yep.
Do you remember when Benson was the understudy for the Broadway Phantom of the Opera?
Oh, sort of. Michael Crawford.
Yeah.
I remember loving Clayton.
Yes.
You know, and I don't even remember much about him, but that he would just be like, Benson. You know, he'd have that
René
like
Abergenois.
Yeah, yeah.
My brother loved it, and he was, I think he was 3 or 4. And it was like every day he would watch it. My mom told me that, yeah, he would sit down with a donut. I think it was like in reruns or something. He'd watch it in the morning while we were at school.
Oh, wow.
And he'd eat a donut and watch Benson every single morning.
That sounds like it.
Still does.
Yeah, I would. I think I would do that. Well, I don't want to. This will disappoint you guys, but you're just up in Portland, Maine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And Missy Gold from Benson is a psychiatrist in Portland, Maine now.
Really?
No way.
No longer ex?
Yep, she's living up there being a psychiatrist in Portland.
Have you contacted her at all?
I have. She was not interested in guesting. It was very nice.
Really?
But that's what she does now. She's living up
Good
there.
Good for her. That's
a psychiatrist.
Great. That's great.
A lot of them don't like talking about her. They just don't have an interest at all.
A lot of them do. It's there's a few who now have like straight jobs that don't. Like Stacey Keenan.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
She's a defense attorney in the Valley and uses her real name, which is a very long
Well, Chunk from the Goonies, Jeff Cohen.
An entertainment lawyer.
He was our lawyer for a little while, too.
He was my friend's lawyer, too. And I had Troy Slayton, who was Jerry Steiner on Parker Lewis. He's a defense attorney. He's been on.
Yeah.
And he's a talking head a lot on, like, CNN and stuff about, like, legal things.
We went up to the HBO Comedy Festival with Jeff Cohen, Chunk from the Goonies.
Yeah, yeah.
And people would come up to him and say, we heard that you're Chunk from the Goonies. He would always deny it.
Oh, really?
Because
he doesn't look like him now.
No, he's skinny.
His sister was Natalie on Facts of Life.
Oh, was she?
Mindy Cohen's his older sister.
I didn't know that.
You didn't know that?
No.
No idea.
Because he was on Facts of Life a couple times as well, yeah. He was in a couple episodes. That's his older sister. Yep.
Wow.
He, as a kid, he was on a game show called Child's Play, where the premise of the show, and I think this is a brilliant premise for a game show, they would give kids a word that you didn't know, and they'd have video of little kids explaining what it is, and then you have to guess what they're talking about. And he was one of the kids, and he would, you know, explain like war or Camaro or like whatever it is. And it's actually a really entertaining show because like kids just saying weird stuff is always fun. He was one of the kids on that show.
Remember he was in a Disney Sunday Night Movie as well, and then I think that was like the last thing he ever did acting wise. But good for him.
He got out.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I think people either get out and do like a completely different job or end up being a director or something.
Yeah, yeah. Right. They go behind the
Ron
scenes.
Ron Howard.
Which is not a bad move.
Yep.
Joanna Kearns of Growing Pains directs television now. So where were we? Friday night we did, that's 8. So what are we at, 9 o'clock?
Did you do Benson too?
I did Benson, yeah.
Then did you Webster after?
I did Webster.
Yep.
Yeah, I did Webster / Dukes of Hazzard. Like I would flip back and forth.
On the ad for Webster, it was... Yeah. The Special Olympics teaches Webster the meaning of friendship.
This is...
That's very special, isn't it?
Very special.
And very special.
Very, very special.
Yeah.
This is Webster's playmates, which is a weird thing to call his friends, give him an ultimatum. If Special Olympics athlete Daryl, played by Paul Stout, is his friend, Webster is no friend of theirs. This Special Olympics came up a lot. There's an infamous Fall Guy episode where a Special Olympiad runs away and the Fall Guy has to get him back to the Special Olympics. And I think Special Olympics was like every other episode of Highway to Heaven.
But would they get like a Down syndrome actor or would they get like an actor who wasn't actually...
Highway to Heaven, they got a Down syndrome actor.
Okay.
But most of the time it was somebody just playing slow.
Which
was always really embarrassing.
Oh.
But I had Emmanuel Lewis on the show.
Oh, yeah?
Hearing about his experience in Webster was fascinating to me. I ended up feeling just really bad for him.
Really?
He couldn't go anywhere. It was such a huge hit. And he's a kid that grew up in Brooklyn.
Yeah.
And
he's probably like, what, 24 when he made the show or something?
Was he like 11.
Oh, was he? He was a kid then.
Yeah, I mean, he was small.
I'd always heard that he was way older than...
He was older than he was playing, but he definitely wasn't like really old.
Okay.
He was still a kid, but he went school shopping one time at their neighborhood in Brooklyn. And the store got mobbed and they had to lock the doors and people broke through the glass chanting, "We want Webster." And like the police had to come in and it was like, I'm like, that must have been terrifying.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
I live in Brooklyn. I want to go see where that happened. I wonder where the Webster incident, maybe the Webster Mall.
There's a little plaque up there.
Yeah, they have a very little
on this day in 1984.
It's a very
special
plaque.
People chanted, "We want Webster."
Yeah. Also told me one of the weirdest things I've ever heard about Michael Jackson.
Oh boy, there's a lot of photos of them together, right?
They were best
Isn't there one of him on his shoulders or something?
Yeah, they used to go to all the like award shows. Him, Michael Jackson, and Brooke Shields. But Michael Jackson used to come over Manny, as he likes to be called, Manny Lewis's house, and do chores, like mow their lawn, do the dishes, do the laundry. Like he just wanted to come over and do
be
like,
normal for a little while.
Stuff.
Yeah. Interesting.
So like Michael Jackson would be like waxing the floor.
What?
Like he'd call him up and be like, "Hey, can I come over and mow the lawn?"
Wow.
Yeah. I was like, okay.
That's great.
Sure.
Good for Webster.
In the final hour here, 9 o'clock on Friday night, February 3rd.
I'm not happy with this.
I'm fizzling out here too on this.
Friday night was weak.
It was tough.
Friday night was good for parents, I think.
Mm.
Well, I don't know. I had Dallas. And
Dallas?
Yeah, just because I like Patrick Duffy.
We all like Patrick Duffy.
Yeah. Yeah.
Everyone wants Man from Atlantis Patrick Duffy.
Or, yeah,
Step by Step Patrick Duffy.
Yeah, Step by Step Patrick Duffy. That was a show where the parents were too horny.
Oh, yeah.
That's
they were always
like,
yeah.
Well, in college, we called it the Sacred Hour. It was on at 1 o'clock in the morning, and every single night we would get together this group of four dudes, and we would watch Step by Step every
single night.
Two episodes every single night.
It wasn't even thinly veiled, though. He'd be like, "Well, I'm going to go upstairs and nail your mom."
Yes.
Like, he would be like, "Where
exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
I used to have to, when I worked at a local TV affiliate, I used to pick up the mail at the post office every day. And one day I walked in there and these two postmen were having a conversation. This guy goes, "Suzanne Summers." And he was doing like the boob.
Yeah, the gesture. For.
And then the guy goes, no, her legs, them thighs. And the guy goes, no, she's got breast cancer. So he was doing,
the Dolly Parton hand gesture.
Did breast cancer.
Something like a real meeting of the minds you witnessed
there. It was fantastic.
Oh, that's a conversation you don't forget.
Yeah, it was real good. But Patrick Duffy.
You saw a shooting star there.
Yeah, absolutely. I was like, is that the only hand gesture you know? Yeah.
You make a wish when you hear that.
Yeah.
Step by Step was, I had Christine Locken on the show.
Oh, did you really?
Oh, yeah.
Was it pronounced Locken? We always said Laken.
I believe she pronounced it Locken.
Okay, yeah.
But yeah, she had some great step-by-step stories. She's still in touch with Patrick Duffy. And
Was she in The Hottie and the Naughty?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Okay.
She has a really funny show on now on Pop, which used to be TV Guide Channel.
Oh, really?
That's like a fake reality show. It's her, Jody Sweden, and from Party of Five.
It's all old sitcom actresses.
But she has one of the funniest jokes I've ever heard in this show. And I believe she wrote it, and she's like, getting a minivan is like losing your virginity. It hurts at first, but then you just think about all the things you can put in it. Because they're like talking about getting old. And I'm like, that's really funny, but like so gross.
It is for the TV Guide Channel or Pop. Yeah. Wow. Yeah.
But yeah. It's very funny. Highly recommend that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's called Hollywood Sweethearts, I want to say.
Okay. I always loved Christina Lakin in Step by Step.
She's
though.
Great.
Yeah.
She's her and Stacey Keenan was really good.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah.
They were definitely the standouts. And, you know, no one likes Sasha Mitchell.
No,
yeah.
No,
yeah.
No. Who's Josh Byrne?
Yes.
He was the most forgettable.
They wrote him out.
They wrote him out. They just killed him off. They didn't kill him off. They were just like, he's not here anymore.
Yeah, yeah. He's just like, no one cared. No one sucked. No one cared.
He sucked. He wasn't funny. Yeah. He couldn't deliver lines.
You know who he looks exactly like, though?
My buddy Steve Hyden.
Steve Hyden. Michael Flynn, the disgraced Department of Homeland Security advisor.
Yeah.
His son, who's now like on investigation, looks exactly like
Josh Byrne.
Yes.
Huh.
And you're like. What?
I remember Josh Byrne. He'd always have the stupid generic sports shirts. I remember my favorite one is he had one that had a basketball hoop on it. It said Hoopster.
Hoopster.
And I was like, I remember immediately we went trying to find a Hoopster shirt.
On eBay, yeah.
Do you remember the Halloween episode with the ghost? The ghost girl? He like goes out on a date with this girl at a party, turns out to be a ghost.
No.
Oh, God.
We would remember
that. We definitely saw it.
Step by Step?
Yeah, Step by Step. And I believe it's the same episode where the parents get locked up in jail by Don Knotts.
Hmm. Wow.
Playing Barney Fife.
Oh, yeah. Oh, no way. They threw him a bone.
Yeah.
There was one where Stacey Keenan had a nude painting of her.
Yes.
And I always wondered where that painting is, because I would love to have that hanging up in my house.
I can until your parents come over and then.
Well, no, then I cover it up. Yeah. No. I would never show them that.
I mean, I'll ask her. I'll see if I can ask
would
her.
Would you? Thank you. Yeah.
I presume she has it.
Yeah.
So you were with that the last hour. What did you go with?
Well, I would have never watched this as a kid, but I really, the ad in TV Guide got me as an adult was Blue Thunder,
yes,
with Bubba Smith, and yep, it was a drawing there that looked pretty action-packed.
Yeah. And so this is sort of a Knight Rider show about a helicopter plane thing, and it's Bubba Smith and Dick Butkus playing a character named Ski, and this is Bubba, played by Bubba Smith,
yep,
go inside a prison as guard and inmate to find out how a convicted swindler plans to make his escape.
Okay, well, they showed him breaking into the prison in the drawing, you know, and it looked pretty cool. So.
Here's the best part, though. There's a character named Joffo, played by Dana Carvey.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. There we go.
84 then. Huh? That was pre-SNL.
But he was also in a sitcom with Mickey Rooney at this time called One of the Boys.
I think I've heard him talk about that, yeah.
Where Mickey Rooney goes to college with his grandson, played by Dana Carvey, and so he like hangs out with like frat dudes.
Wow. With Mickey Rooney. Is he funny?
No,
oh,
it's terrible.
That was Chopping Broccoli, Star Search era, though. Yep, Dana Carvey,
Turkey TV, SNL. Chopping Broccoli.
Yeah,
and I do want to mention at 10, even though it's outside the purview here, Lorne Michaels' new show is on, which was
I never saw
the
that
news show.
But...
The new show.
Oh,
so
the new
when
show.
He wasn't doing SNL, he started his own different SNL. And this is like when Dick Ebersol was producing SNL. So the cast was incredible. It was like mostly SCTV people and Jeff Goldblum and Steve Martin. And this one is Penny Marshall, Raul Julia, and singer Randy Newman.
Whoa. And,
it was just a really weird show.
Yeah.
Just a variety show?
It was SNL. It was basically SNL.
Sketches.
But he called it the new show. And one of my favorite sketches they did was John Candy plays a guy who owns a food repair business. So it's like people come in and they're like, I bought these chips and they're all broken. And he's like, okay, it's a lot of man hours. And he like gives him a prize.
It's a good premise.
It's like this really weird sketch. Well, someone would be like, I was carving this turkey. And he goes, we can fix that up. It's up on YouTube. It's one of the only sketches.
Oh, yeah?
But it's really funny and weird.
Huh.
And there was some. Jack Handy started on that show. Deep Thoughts was first on the new show.
Oh, okay.
Oh, really?
Did he play a character or did he do deep writer?
So it was like when Lorne Michaels came back, he took a bunch of the people from the new show and then a bunch of people from Mike Nesmith's television parts, which NBC had tried to get to replace SNL because they were going to cancel it in 85, and kind of just hired all these people from those shows. But the new show is no one ever talks about it. And
how did it last a season? It was one season.
But it was, there's some really funny stuff on it. Catherine O'Hara, John Candy, Dave Thomas.
Oh, so a lot of the SCTV. People.
Almost the entire SCTV cast.
Wow. Yeah.
And plus Jeff Goldblum.
Wow.
It's very weird.
That sounds great.
It's really good.
I also noticed Monty Python was on at 9:30.
Yes.
So that was a PBS airing at the time. So, yeah.
That's a good sketch comedy night right there.
Yeah, that is. Yeah.
Oh, Friday night. Yeah, you want some laughs on Friday.
Yeah.
You want to unwind.
Right.
Laugh. It's Friday.
Blow some steam from the
hard day
work week.
You just watched something about the Batan Death March survivors.
Yeah, I know. Even that dog fashion show
it can only soften the blow so much. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for doing this, guys. It's been great talking to you.
Yeah, thanks, Ken.
There you have it. Very good episode. I really enjoyed talking to those guys. Highly recommend you follow them on social media. Nick especially has an amazing Instagram, and I'm incredibly jealous because he has his own cherry from Pee-wee's Playhouse. He had a chair basically upholstered to look just like Cherry, and I am incredibly jealous of him. Very funny. Those guys are always traveling around, posting fun stuff, and check out their DVDs, Found Footage Fest. I think it's foundfootagefest.com, but I'll put up links on TVGuidanceCounselor.com.
You can also go to icanread.com and get links to all my other social media stuff, all the TV Guidance Counselor stuff. You can buy I Can Read merchandise. You can buy my albums. You can buy TV Guidance Counselor merchandise. You can also go to my Patreon, which is patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor. I fund the show myself. We don't have ads, and I'm happy to do that. But there are some costs. I have to feed people when they come over my house. But there's a little bit of technical costs, some web hosting, some travel costs. If I get a good amount of money, hopefully I'll be out in LA soon and get you some Hollywood Good Times episodes. But if you don't have the means to give anything, that's fine too. I just appreciate you listening. And we are here each and every Wednesday with bonus episodes sometimes, so be sure you subscribe to the show. And we'll see you again next time on a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Jerry's found the diapers. You can only grab five.